Hey, horse people. Good morning. Sunday. Up all night listening to freaking thunder. It was crazy. But I hope if we got as much rain as we got thunder, I'll be happy. But I walked by my pond this morning. It's pretty low. Okay. Let's see where this... I'm going to try to go back over some of the earlier comments if I can get them. So who was the first person? Natalie. First one here. Hey. All right. I don't know if there was a conversation here in the old comments. Morning, horsey people. Good morning. Good morning. Too much alcohol. Ooh, somebody got hungover. More buddy was doing a happy, maybe buddy. They're all wet standing out there. I didn't feed them this morning. They're both looking a little chunky. So they didn't get any food this morning. Rick, that's mean. Whatever. Oh, did I forget to turn on my, is this thing on like a slowdown so I don't get any spam? All right, let me share. What is this? Present, share screen so I can get my horsey videos up and talk about me on what I did wrong. Okay, so there's all kind of, I can get rid of that. I already played the song. Which one is this? This is part three. I want part one. And there was some interesting comments on this. So if you didn't watch the three-part series on Buddy Barking, that's what this is going to be because I want to make this part four. So I'm going to try to stay on the topic of just Buddy. 10 a.m. in Pennsylvania. I like when I know what Hey, horse people. What time is it like Australia? We're too fast for Rick. He's gotten slow us down. What? We're too fast. What the hell? All right. So, on the first part, I don't think there was too much besides Buddy.
Okay. I'm going to beat him. I'm going to beat it.
I want to get to where... Some people thought him throwing the saddle off was disrespectful. He didn't calculate. I mean, I kind of act like he's interacting with me, but he's just being a horse. He's nosy. He's going to stick his nose on something. He's going to get into things. He doesn't want to be tied. That's just normal horsey behavior. But I don't think that was him being mean. What else we do here? Cinch, some people said you don't need the rear. Oh, everybody was commenting on the apples. I always called them horse apples and crap apples. Everybody was calling them something different. I'm not sure. I wasn't really watching Ransom doing this whole thing, so I don't really know what he was doing. A lot of people were commenting on him. For those that didn't know, when I had Mr. T talking, this guy's Mr. T. On the other side, I painted Mr. T's brand here. So, Buddy, when he stands tied up, he's always got Mr. T next to him. So, there's a little brand on the other side, the same size of the neck that Mr. T. So, when Mr. T talks to him, I usually put the little speech box from this little thing here. Mr. T is buried back out here by this tree, but this is Mr. T that's talking. Oh, shit. So, that one's over. Not too much in the first one. Let me look at some of the comments because there were some interesting comments. First, let's see what the top comments are. The man on the horse in the beginning is bringing hostility, including fear, and has no connection with his horse. Seriously, beat him. Okay. Freaking crazy people. So people, and I get it, they don't know me. So they come here, they're new, and they're seeing some guy talking about I'm going to beat my horse. And they're like, this guy is mean. They know I don't beat my, they don't know that I don't beat my horse. My regular people know. Some people say you shouldn't do that because you're scaring away new viewers. Whatever. I mean, if viewers are going to make that quick of a judgment on something, they're going to make a quick judgment on something else when I talk about pink or women or whatever. So let's see what Seven replies, how my viewers got on them. Oh, my God. There's no broom parking here. Oh, that was my comment. No, clearly no connection to the horse because he's not riding him with a pink whip boots. And... Nice, Megan. You are on, you may be new to this channel, so I'll be serious. Rick's joking. He wouldn't be Buddy. Thank you. Mags. And then someone else, oh my gosh, stop. Let's see. Buddy can't believe this is happening. All right, let me try to get to the ones that I commented. Where's my, oh, I can't do the filter here. Damn. I'll do that later. Let's get to part two. So let's discuss some of the things that Buddy was doing that I really couldn't articulate as well. And if you guys want a question, maybe I'll see if you can put either a lot of red, either red hearts, red fireman, red horse, whatever. Just something red 3 or 4 times. Don't go overboard. So it might catch my eye as the comments are scamming the eye. Normally I'm looking over here because my mouse is over here and I can point to things. So I'm watching the video on this screen. The comments are over here. So I'm going to miss a lot of comments. So here we go. Let's, is he uncomfortable? Okay. So you notice right here that Ransom's kind of holding his own. He's not threatened by me or the horse. To me, that's a good thing. Some people are going to say he should have moved out of your space. When you walk, you shouldn't have walked by the rear, blah, 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 blah. You know, look, you need to know your horses. I wouldn't walk that close to a horse that I didn't know because this horse may kick this horse. I know these horses aren't going to kick. I know Ransom's lower. He's not going to kick. So there's no reason for me to be concerned about walking by his rear feet there and being worried about getting kicked or the horse is starting to fight. If anything's going to happen, Buddy, because he's high horse, is going to bite Ransom on a butt, and he's going to run away. So this is, again, I don't lunge my horses. I rarely lunge my horses. I did this totally for you guys. If it would have just been me riding without this, I'd have went out there. I might have made him change directions once or twice and got on him. But I'm just not that concerned about Buddy. He's going to act up. He's going to be a horse. And I just deal with it in a saddle. I know some people either, and I'm not cracking on you, not as confident in a saddle to deal with it, or their horse, if you deal with in a saddle, gets too aggressive and he won't stop and you can't stop him. He doesn't respect you enough to stop him. And so you either jump off or you taught him that if he does a little bit, you jump off to correct him on the ground. I think that's a bad technique, but if it's safe and it works for you, I don't care. I don't want you to do everything I'm telling you. I just want you to understand what's in my mind and why I do what I do. I think it works. I think I have a good relationship with horses, even horses I don't know, strange horses. So if you want to use it, you can. This isn't a competition of me making you into a little Rick. It really isn't. All right, so I've got a thing here. People ask why I was wearing these chaps. You see these leather straps right here? This connects with this rough. My saddle is called a rough out. So when you have a leather saddle, you can either have leather the smooth side out because it looks smooth and shiny, which most women like. Rick, why are you picking on women? I'm not. I'm just saying. Most women like that. Or you can flip the leather upside down. And it's called a rough out to the rough side of the leather. It's not smooth and polished. So it gives more gripping action. When you have that rough side and then you have leather chaps on, it creates a good friction and holds you in a saddle a little bit better. So if you're going uphills, downhills, or moving or cutting cattle or doing a lot of change in directions, that will help you stay in a saddle a little bit better. Also, chinks flap so the heat flies away. It's like having a fly swatter on both legs. They flap around. So the flies stay away from your horse and you. Also, if you run by tall bushes and it scratches, it won't tear up your pants. You won't get stickers because it hits the leather and it goes off. It doesn't stick as much. So that's for the chaps thing question. This is a very mild kind of lunge. I'm not even saying it's really an aggressive lunge. It is just kind of, you know, whatever. Let me move you and change. The whole purpose is the horse responding to you? Is he watching me? Is he paying attention to me? On this little lunge here, he was doing pretty nice, but in a minute he wasn't very nice.
Okay,
here,
pretty slow, not a whole lot of movement.
See, he's very, but I can just tell, and you may not be able to, and I'm not saying I'm some horse whisperer and I know all these secrets, and because we're in touch and we do yoga together, and it's not that. It's just I can look at my horse and know he's just standing a little taller, his steps aren't normal. He just is a little cautious in his step. He's not relaxed, kind of like playful. Yeah, let's go this. I want to go eat. He's not doing that. So that's why I saw he's not comfortable. Does that matter to me? No, like I said, I would have just got on him. The only reason I did the steps I did is to show you how you can prepare your horse. Look, for a horse to buck, they usually have to be fresh. I don't like promoting wearing a horse out before you get on them. However, nothing's written in stone. And if it makes you feel safe, a horse will always buck less if they're tired. I mean, that's just the way. You know, the Indians, they used to put their horses for new horses in the river, up to the water, and let them buck all they wanted in the water because they couldn't buck, they couldn't jump. The water was, and they would wear out and get tired really quick. And then they'd ride them out of the lake or the stream. So a tired horse isn't going to buck as much. I don't like the method of wearing a horse out. If I had an emergency or if I had to get a horse ready quickly, or if there was a situation where I didn't have time and I have to get on this horse, I would wear his butt out before I got on him if I thought he was rank or, you know, and I say the term rank, that's this, they call a rank horse, a horse that is bucky, or a cold back is another term they use. But he's a little cold back. If you get on him right away and run him, he's going to buck every time. It's just the way he is. I get it. If you walk him around, let him get a sweat, let him get used to it, let him forget, do a trot, and then do a run, he's usually okay. That's why this buck kind of caught me off guard. I thought I did enough to where he wouldn't buck. Let's see. So far, I don't see any questions over there, so we're doing good. All right, so when you're observing your horse, again, the things I'm looking for, is Buddy looking at me right now, or is he looking out to pasture? He's looking out to pasture where he wants to be. He doesn't want to be with me. He's looking out to pasture. Is Ransom looking at me? No. He's not. Both these horses are paying about the same amount of attention to me.
So this is, he's responsive. And
he didn't even look at me there. I mean, he kind of turned his head. He's not being resistance because that's just how he is. But
he's telling me he's okay. But I want to see him move a little bit before I get on. Hey.
When I say move, I want to see him move. I'm talking about I want to get a couple of good strides to where he feels that saddle bouncing. He feels this thing hanging here, which is called a shoe fly. I've got a video on it. If you want to look it up, shoe fly. It swings and it shoes the fly underneath his belly because that's where the flies like to get, especially when it's hot because it's shady underneath the horse's belly. So the flies will go to the shade and get out of the heat. So they hang on their belly. That thing kind of flops around and keeps, because I don't want my horse biting at his belly, kicking at his belly, being irritated, not listening to me when I'm riding him. So putting a shoe fly on. I used to have one on the back extension that broke off. I just haven't put it back yet. But that's what that is. I want all these things flapping, and I want the horse to feel it before I get on him, and he feels it the first time with me on his back. Okay? So that's what we're doing here. So I really had to turn up the energy here because Buddy was just like, yeah, whatever. He wants me to walk. I don't really want to move. So when I jumped and kind of got on him and aggressive, this is me being aggressive in case you can't know. I was trying to turn my energy up saying, hey, I want you to move, get going. I wanted to almost instill that little bit of a flight response. I'm going to get you. I'm threatening you. I'm the high horse. I'm pinning my ears. I'm going to bite you. I'm telling you to move. I'm snaking you. That's how a stallion, a high horse would do it in the wild. I have to try and do that. Leaning forward, sticking my head out. Hey, pay attention to me, making myself bigger. And he picked up his speed.
Pick up my energy. He picks up his energy.
Because I talked to you, the camera, he immediately ignored me. That's why I tell people to be quiet. I want you to notice, as soon as I get him moving good and I start telling you what I did, he's like, he's not paying attention to me, and he slows down. Watch it.
Pick up my energy, he picks up his energy.
He slows down because I ignored him. He knows I wasn't focused on him. He's never done this before. Maybe he's done it and I didn't think a big deal of it, but this was a little bit of an aggressive. I kind of wanted to get on him a little bit harder than I did. I would have probably popped him with a rope if I had a long enough rope when he did that. If I could get the timing down, doing it later is bad. It's no good. But if I could have done it as soon as he put that butt and you saw me jump back, because people always wonder, what do you do when a horse threatens you? Exactly what I did. You get to a point of safety, but you don't wait or do it. You immediately put pressure on and tell him, no, don't do that. What most people do is they get far away and they keep going away and they're concerned and they don't want to do it again. They don't want to shop prepared. And then the horse like, oh, okay, I know how to stop this person. I know how to stop pressure. I'll just threaten. You watch. As soon as he threatens me, I make sure I'm out of the kick zone just enough in case he does fire at me. And then I immediately put pressure.
Oh, did you see that buddy try to kick me? You better get.
Did it again. That time, I did not stop pressure because I knew I screwed it up on the first one. See, he got too relaxed here. Too much time. That leg come out right here. I mean, that is a definite threat. Now, I am far out of the kick zone here, but that is a definite threatening kick. Like, hey, quit putting pressure on me. I don't want to run. Why are you making me? This is a horse telling you no. It's not a major no. It's not I'm going to kill you a no, but he's telling me no. I do not like when horses tell me no. They all do it because they don't like to be pushed. They don't like pressure. They don't want to work when they don't have to. They want to see if I really have to do this. They want to see if the person making me do this really can make me do this. It's just what they do. It's not personal. It's not breeding. It's not the last trainer. It's not their color. It's none of that crap.
Okay, you see that little kind of...
Now see, had I not been videotaping, he would have done like two circles really, really fast, almost to where he was slipping. I would have had him running so fast for two circles, then I would have stopped him and he would have turned around and snorted because he'd have been out of breath and he would have looked right at me and gave me a big blow like, okay, I got it. And then we would have went back to normal. Because I was talking to you guys, I kind of let him get away with that a little bit. Had I ran him continuously right here and really made him move his butt for two circles and then stopped his movement. Because remember, a lot of people are really good about moving a horse and making them run, but they don't connect that it's not just making them run. It's stopping them from running. It's changing their direction in running. It's stopping them and making them look at you and look you eye to eye and show you respect. It's starting their movement again slowly after you made them run. All those things show intricate, delicate control of your horse versus show him who's boss, get that whip, run him around in circles till he can't breathe. I'll show that horse. Don't you kick at me, blah, blah, blah. That to me, that's kind of kindergarten horse training shit. But if you want to get more finesse, you need to understand I'm not just running him to punish, to be mad, to show how strong I am. I'm doing it with purpose and for a reason. I want to control his feet. I want his feet to go faster and slower. I want him to trot. I want him to run. I want him to walk. I want to stop his forward movement. I want him to face me. I want him to change direction smoothly. I want him to start saying, it's cool. This guy's in charge. I'll just listen to him. I don't want this no, this reactive, this bucking, this threatening to kick, this high prance shit. I don't want that in a horse. But does it bother me if Buddy does it? It doesn't. I mean, I'm doing these videos to teach people. So sometimes I do shit that I normally wouldn't sweat only for demonstrations. So people that are watching can kind of like, okay, I kind of see what happens when it goes bad. What do I do if it goes bad? If I only cut out and show me looking like a freaking great, wonderful horseman with the perfect horse that never does anything, then you never learn. To me, that's kind of cheating the viewer and you're stealing views. I am who I am. My horses are who they are. And I want to teach you. A lot of times I set up failure. I do things that I know is going to happen that I could prevent, but I let it happen because it ain't a big deal. I know I can fix it. I know it's not the end of the world. And it's a good demonstration for you guys. All right.
Okay. You see that little kind of his butt trying to kick me.
Now, right here, he kind of hooked up with me. You see that little hook on? He's like, dude, I better get next to him. I don't want him to run me again. So this some people may confuse this as, oh, you got him. You did everything perfect. Look how he came right up on you. He came up on me because he's trying to milk me and try to tell me, yeah, okay, I'm with you. But we're not connected. His head is still high. He's still prancing. I mean, he's showing me some respect. And he's like, damn, why is Dad doing this? Dad doesn't know. So he's responding differently because I'm responding differently. So
saying, don't make me run.
Is he looking at me or is he looking around? Is he looking for an escape path? Is he looking for his horse? Is he looking at where he wants to be rather than at me? He's not what I would call locked onto me. And I don't like robot horses. I don't care if he looks around. I don't care if he's not paying attention. I don't care if he throws a buck. It's not a big deal to me. Other people, you know, I told you about the owner of Buddy. I rode some of other horses and they would buck and I would kind of laugh and just ride out the buck. And she's like, it's not funny. You may like them to buck. And it's not that I liked them to buck. I thought, well, maybe I did like it a little bit because it was kind of funny. But she thought that I was, because she wanted to blame everybody but her. She didn't want to accept responsibility that they buck with her, or she doesn't want to buck with her, or she's nervous that they'll buck. And she's a different kind of rider than I was. Remember, she had a horse that she said wouldn't go in water. Her horse is scared of water. It was Buddy's mom. I want to say it was, what was that horse's name? Was it Maggie or Marge? Wouldn't go in water. I go, that's crazy. A horse will go through water. No, Rick, I don't know what it is. I've had this horse 13 years. It won't go. But, and you remember, she had 13 horses, big show horse people, all this shit. I mean, she was a girl. She said they'd have like horsey parties before they went to shows, and all the girls would meet early and they would shine up their hooves and braid and talk. And it was a girly thing. I don't mind girls being girls, whatever. That's not, people think that I hate women. I hate girly. It's not that, people. I don't like when women get out here and teach stupid shit and do stupid shit with horses because they don't know the difference of having fun and babying your horse and making a horse dangerous to where you're going to get your ass hurt. And then you blame the horse because you don't want to accept responsibility for actions because you got participation trophy your whole life and told how great and equal you are. And you can't ever be told anything that you do wrong. Otherwise, it'll crush your rice paper feelings. That's my problem with horse women that get horses hurt or killed because of their stupid crap. Rick, why are you up? All right, whatever.
No, he doesn't like it.
Okay, so this one, I want you to notice that to get him to move, if you notice on the earlier ones, I had to, come on, buddy, let's go, come on. I had to kind of work at getting him to move. Watch how little I do to get him to move this time. Very low energy, very low swinging, didn't close. He's like, I got it, I got to move. Notice he didn't react that time. You guys didn't know it, but I wanted to see if he was going to kick out at me again. That's why I did that. Right here, I challenge him and threaten him like he threatened me. Because if he threatens me again when I threaten him, he was going to get it. But he didn't. He moved away and went, whoa, okay, I don't want any part of this. I don't want to challenge you. I don't want to kick out. That's a big difference than the earlier, hey, get away from me. Get away. Big change. I can't explain all this when I'm doing these videos. Watching it, I can explain what's going through my mind, etc. So hopefully people will watch this and understand it a little bit better. How old is Buddy now? I don't know how old Buddy is now. You have to go to the website. somebody here will know, I'm sure. Hello from Scotland. Rick loves women. Judy Booty. Hey, Judy, with your little guns, with all kind of guns. Anyway, all right, let me get back to this video. I'm trying to keep on horses here. Did y'all see that little no there? He just gave me a no again. When I put pressure, he gave me pressure back. I don't want pressure. When I give a horse pressure, I want release. I want that horse to go, I don't want pressure. I'm going to yield to pressure. I don't want to challenge pressure. That's when I give pressure what I want from a horse. Buddy right here gave me pressure. Did you see that pressure? To me, it was very clear. Head low, walking like a good horse, relaxed spots. Watch the pressure. I gave him pressure. See that bowing? That bucking like, hey, I want to look bigger. Hey, started prancing, tail going up. Total pressure. When I'm doing this, I see this and I react, but I can't explain it like I can now. So these are the things you're looking at when you're evaluating and looking at a horse. Buddy was, I don't know if I'd say challenging, but he damn sure wasn't being submissive and 100% saying, I get it. You're the boss. You can do what you want and I'll accept it. And I won't say no. This is a precursor to the buck. This is when you put pressure on me, I'm going to put pressure on you. When I wanted him to run and put pressure on him to run, he gave me pressure back and saying, no, I want a buck. It's all connected.
Don't you tell me, John. Go the other way. Go the other way. Come on.
That was a nice turn. He walked off more calmly. Head still a little bobbing, still a little high. Still not yes and submissive completely. But again, I don't like robot horses. I was doing this more for...
You're going to be in big trouble, mister.
That was confusion. That was not a threat. He thought I wanted him to stop because I stopped pressure. Watch this closely here. So he's like asking me here, this is not a threat. He's going to turn and want to face me and say, oh, he stopped pressure. Maybe I'm supposed to face him. He doesn't want me to move. So this is a miscommunication. He asked, do you want me to face you? And then I gave him pressure and said, no, I want you to move. Watch it. So see, that wasn't a challenge. Some people may, don't you challenge me. I told you to move. You should move. He didn't know I wanted to move. He wasn't being bad here. That was a very good stop. I like when a horse swings his butt away and faces me immediately instead of this slow trot to a stop.
Okay, so I like that. That hose very light. I got it. I'm sorry.
Is he looking at me? He was looking at me. He was looking at me when he walked up. Watch this. Staring at me. Two ears. Okay, nice face. Nice ears.
Like that.
As soon as I look away and start talking to camera, I lose him.
Light. I got it.
There he goes. He's looking at where I want to be, where I wish I was at. I want to be with Ransom. He's talking to Ransom right now. They're having a conversation. Probably this crazy human's pissing me off. I don't know what they're saying, but he ain't looking at me.
Sorry. So he's being a little bit more... He's still a little fired up. I want to get on him.
When I say he's still a little fired up, what I was insinuating was all of his actions are he's not locked on. He's probably not ready to be ridden. I had a few comments where people were like, you're an idiot. You should have never got on him. You caused this. This is all your fault. You ruined that horse by making him buck because you got on him when you shouldn't have. I could tell that you shouldn't have got on. Look, because you think the horse is unrideable, I don't care. I'm riding him. I get on it. It's my decision. Okay. That's the problem with horsewomen is they always want to hold everybody to their minimum standard. If I can't do it, then nobody else should do it. I can't ride in a halter. Everybody should ride in a bit. So I'm not the only one riding in a bit. I can't ride without a helmet because I'm afraid. Everybody should wear a helmet. That really irritates me. I don't like that shit. I don't give a shit what you do with your horse. But don't come here and tell me that I'm wrong because I do something that you can't do or you're scared to do or you're not comfortable or confident to do. Don't tell me that I need to run my horse just like you because you're scared of everything your horse does. That's doesn't fly with me. Rick, you just hate women.
I'm right here and just walk him a little bit and flex his head.
Okay, so I put on my... Another thing that somebody was trying to tell me is that that arrow, by the way, was pointing to his ears, kind of going back on me. Sometimes ears go back to pay attention to what you're doing. At what age should you stop riding? Are you talking about a human age or a horsey age? You can ride as long as you want to get up there and get on it for a human. For a horse, as soon as a horse starts to me feeling pain, it's not comfortable, he limps, he's sore. His muscle mass goes away. He moves slowly. He has a hard time carrying you. Again, too many factors. How big are you? How big's your horse? How muscly? How much do you ride? Do you ride like I did, walking him around flat pasture and not really requiring much of him? Or do you go out in trails and you're running him up and down hills and you're making him jump creeks and climb up and you're doing all this other stuff? I mean, I used to ride Buddy hard when he was younger. We'd go to some really rough areas. He'd be sweating and we'd go up some steep hills and down some steep and through some rough terrain. So it depends on how you're riding them. So I can't really answer that one. Okay. Let's see here. Where am I at here? Hang on. I got to get rid of that.
Instead of one.
So when I tighten up the cinch right here, you should always tighten up your cinch. I tell people at least three times. People that do the cinch one time, to me, that's bad horsemanship. They get that cinch and it's like, rip, rip, kick the knee, make him exhale, rip, rip. pull, yank, snap, and then they connect the cinch, and then that's easy. See, if it's easy for the human, it's usually not good for the horse. I put the thing on snug the first time, move them around. I snug it up a little bit more, move them around, and I snug it up again before I get on. They say a smart horseman will never get on a horse without checking his cinch. You know, that it used to be a thing for the old cowboys to be like, before you get on, hey, don't forget to check your cinch. It was just kind of one of those things to be careful, because cinch could come loose. Somebody can play a joke. There could have been a small tear that's walked out. And when you check it this time, you rip that tear. You may see a tear that you didn't see. You may notice, you know, a wasp standing on your cinch that could sting your horse that you need. You may notice a big sticker spur that you didn't know that you picked up that may. You always want to check your cinch before you get on the horse.
This is my bad leg that I have.
Dude, I'm telling you, man, everybody's giving me input on my knee, which some of it's pretty good, but this, it hurts right here in my butt, on my hip, on the side, and then right up along my back, and then along my groin. And I'm telling you, man, I think it's gotten better because I've been doing a little bit more stretching, and I think stretching is making it better. When I got on this horse and I did the splits on that horse, man, on the inside right here, it just freaking hurt. Ugh. I showed my bruise on the other one. I don't know, all the bruises are still there. I don't know if you guys can see it. Everybody said I was flashing them. You guys can't see it that much, but anyway. Somebody said I should have a mounting block because of this. Yeah, I mean, maybe I should. I mean, I crack on mounting blocks so much. As soon as I use one, I know every barn witch in the world would be like, he's always killing it, baby. The reason I don't like mounting blocks is because most people that use them are overweight, out of shape, shouldn't get on a damn horse, can't get on a horse, not because of an injury, because they're so out of shape and overweight that they need to be hoisted up there with a freaking crane and a winch. Next thing, we'll have horsey cranes that pick you up and set you on a horse so it'll be easier. And then you wonder why you fall off, why you're always using big bits, so you can't control your horse because you're out of shape. That's why I don't like mounting blocks. But everyone else, like they say, I hate women, think I hate mounting blocks. I don't have a problem mounting blocks. Mounting blocks are fine if you're using it because of terrain or you want to be easy on a horse or etc. But if you can't, most people use a mounting block because they can't get on without it. That's why I don't like mounting blocks. All right. But anyway. Okay. When I get on here, this is a bad way to get on a horse. Normally, you want to jump and bounce high of center very quickly. You don't want to pull your horse. But he's a big horse, 1,250 pounds. He's pretty strong. I had to literally pull myself up, which is not a good way. That shows, normally it would show that I'm out of shape to be riding. I don't think I'm out of shape to be riding. That injury prevented me from doing my normal jump up high center of the gravity. So this is not a good way to pull. I see a lot of people doing that. And that's why people go, you shouldn't even mad, but it's good for the horse. It ain't good for the horse. It's good for you. Quit using a horse as an excuse for your lazy ass not getting out there and being able to get on a horse without a mounting block.
Oh, I didn't like that one.
Very disrespectful. When I say disrespectful, that's just a common term that you use. The horse wasn't being mean or trying to diss me. He was just like not paying attention. He was like, you're on me. I'm going to walk off. I know where I want to go. I want to go this way and I'm moving. I don't need to listen to you. You're not in charge. I'll be in charge. Just sit up there and shut up and go for the ride. You're either riding or you're driving when you're on a horse. And I see a lot of riders, and riders are the ones that get in trouble, get hurt, get flipped, get hurt. Drivers usually don't, unless they're driving like an idiot, and then they end up getting their horse in trouble. So I got in trouble with that Yvonne lady. I use a block. I'm not out of shape or overweight. I'm short and probably considered old. Well, that's okay. I mean, look. Again, I don't care if you use a block. The reason I don't promote or like blocks, because everyone I see using them shouldn't be on a damn horse. I mean, it's just like you couldn't get on that horse yet. If they have to get up, I've got videos where women that use a mounting block, they go out and ride, and then for some reason they have to get off their horse or their horse tosses them. Usually the horse doesn't toss them. They fall off their horse and they say their horse tossed them. But anyway, they end up on the ground and they can't get back on their horse because they don't have a mounting block. That's the fallacy. Now, if you're only riding in an arena and your mounting block is always next to you and you're riding on sand and you got your big dressage bit and freaking whip and all your other shit, and you go around in circles and the lights to impress everybody on how good you look, and that's all you do, then get on and off on a mounting block. I don't care. Whatever. All right. Let's see here. Okay, so when he walked off, anytime you make a horse back up is something that horses don't like to do. When a horse backs away from another horse, they're showing submission. They're like, you're high horse. I'm giving you your space. I get it. So backing up is not a normal thing. It's normally due to, I want to avoid trouble or show respect or back away. So when you get on a horse and you make him back up, although he's not backing away from someone giving him pressure, he's still in his mind, it's a submissive move. I don't normally do that. I can't see where I'm going. I don't know if there's a predator behind me. It's not a normal back. You don't see horses out in the field doing a moonwalk, just backing up for no reason. When a horse backs up, it's for a reason. So when you're on a horse and you get him to back up lightly, the horse is really showing you that I get it. You can control my feet. I don't like backing up, but you told me to back up, so I'm going to back up. Backing up is a good, good exercise. I don't want to say overdo it and do a whole bunch. There's a lot of people that overdo it. But, you know, they say if you want your horse to stop better, every time you stop him, make him back up 3 steps. So you go, whoa, and as soon as he stops and stops his forward movement, back, back, back. And pretty soon, if you do that every time, your horse will anticipate that I'm going to have to back up every time I stop. Because that's what horses do. They anticipate. That's why people don't understand horses. Always like, that horse is anticipating. He shouldn't. He should be waiting to listen. Shut up with your stupid shit. Sometimes he should know what not and listen. But I don't care if my horse anticipates. It makes it a training. I can train him easier. So by backing him up, every time you stop, you teach your horse that I'm going to back up when I stop. Guess what? He anticipates that. When he stops, he's already getting his butt down and his legs underneath him to back up. That makes him stop better because he's anticipating the back up. When a horse is stopping, anticipating the back up, their stop is better. Their butt drops and they get a better stop because they're ready to back up. So if you want to get your horse a better stop, have him back up before. Don't do it all the time and harass him, and don't use pain bits and hurt his mouth to do it. But if you do it right, it can be a good tool. All right. Can women use pressure and release second helmet? Hell yeah, they can. They do it all the time. They nag, nag, nag. And guys will go do something to stop the nagging. Nagging is pressure for men because we understand the words and we don't want to hear it. Horses nag, nag, nag doesn't mean nothing. They just hear wah, 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 and they still ignore you. Okay? A lot of kids ignore their moms. Ma, 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 wait till your dad go. Ma, 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 ma. The pressure means nothing if you use it all the time. So if you nag all the time, guys will get desensitized to it and it'll be like, whatever. But pressure and release is, we get it from bosses, from each other, in relationships, in traffic. People put pressure on you. You give a signal. They pull into your lane. They're putting pressure. You either release, you speed up. Pressure and release is just all around us. People just don't connect it so much. All right. So I had him back up.
Because I wasn't paying.
And he moved again after I backed him up. Again, this is telling me I'm not paying attention. You don't have my mind. I'm going to do what I want to do. I don't have to listen to you. All these are clues that when you put pressure in a canter or something and he wants to buck, he's going to buck because that's how he says, no, I don't think I should have to listen to you. I want to do what I want to do. Do I want a robot horse every time? I don't. It's not a big deal to me. Whatever. I mean, he's, again, I was doing this to demonstrate. A lot of people were like the barn witches that follow me because they know what I'm talking about. I know you're out there. You don't have to. You'll be watching later. I know you know what I'm talking about, and it drives you nuts because you don't like me and because you're freaking a barn witch and you know it and you don't like when I call you out. But whatever. You still watch me. I call it my little ghost viewers. Anyway, they will come here, and they took this opportunity to say, you can't read a horse. You don't know what you're doing. You should have never got on that horse. That horse was giving you signals. You missed it. I didn't miss shit. I mean, maybe I missed some things. Maybe I don't see everything. But I knew exactly what I was doing and what I was getting into. It wasn't the end of the world. I know I can handle it. It's not the end of the world. Whatever.
Pay attention. I didn't tell him what to do. This pulling right here, I don't like that.
I'm changing his direction and moving his feet. That's why I'm doing this. I want to see how much resistance. He's already given me resistance. He's walking off. That's resistance. I didn't tell him to walk off. When I backed him up, he tried to walk forward. That's resistance. I didn't tell him to walk forward. So now I want to do other things to get him to stop resisting. I changed his direction. I changed his movement. I made him move forward. I'm still getting a little resistance. Usually his tail hangs pretty flat when he's relaxed. See how Ransom's tail is hanging flat? That's how Buddy normally is. Even when I'm riding him, it's swinging and relaxed. This tail isn't relaxed.
See how light he is?
Now, what I also did is I wanted to put pressure behind him. Who knows what I mean by putting pressure behind him? Let's see if I can get a question here. I'll get some interaction with my viewers here. I'm a little late. You missed everything. You can't be here because you're late. Get out. I'm only kidding. All right. So who thinks, what's the pressure? When I did this, I said I put pressure behind him. What's the pressure? Somebody explain to me what I meant when I said I put pressure behind him right now. I'm kind of interested to see. This is Folgers in here. Who cares? I don't drink coffee. I'm a Mormon. I know a lot of Mormons that drink coffee. Hey, very nice, Jill. That's exactly correct. I wonder who else gets that. Ransom is pressure. Man, I love it. Legs, gutter girl, you blew it. Get out of here. Sit back. Nope. It was Ransom. Wiggled in a saddle. No. Backing him toward Ransom. Okay. Not necessarily backing him toward Ransom because that's what he wants. If I back him toward Ransom, he wants that. I'm releasing pressure. I turned him away from his buddy in the pasture where he wants to be. Now that has created a draw, a different type of pressure that's going to draw him into, hey, I want to be there. I want to turn around. I want to look at my friends. I wanted to create that draw and pressure to the rear to see if he would listen to me or he wouldn't listen to me. So all that's going on in my head that I can't explain. Pressure from the other horse. Good. I don't know if people are saying that because I gave away the answer, but that's good. I was right. Good job. A lot of people were right. So that's good that you're thinking, because when you start thinking like a horse on how they perceive their world, you understand why they're doing and you don't personalize it. He's turning because he doesn't like me. He's turning because I'm not tough enough. He's turning because he's disrespecting. You stop all that bullshit that humans like to use and you start getting in the horse's mind and say, okay, he wants to be with his friends. I get it. I like being with my friends. I like having whatever. I get it. He's not being mean, but I still want his mind because the mind controls the feet and I want him paying attention to me. I want to stop that focus on everything else. When a horse is focusing on everything else, you scare him sometimes when you ask him something and he's like, oh, I forgot what you were up there. I never want a horse to forget I'm up there. I'm either petting, scratching. Anytime I sit very still and just kind of observe the view and my horse kind of looks around, he'll start eating the grass and I just sit up there and we both get relaxed and we're just having a good calming riding moment. I always very calmly or slightly scratch him, talk to him, good boy, do something to where he remembers, because I don't want to just immediately, it's all quiet, we're all relaxed, all of a sudden I pick up the reins and pull on him. He's like, whoa, what the shit? I forgot a rider was there. I forgot there was, and he spooks and he bucks and he takes off and he's like, holy, and you put him in fight or flight and you didn't even realize it because you let him get so relaxed that you both became in your own little world. You came back, but you didn't give him a chance to come back. And he's a flight animal and you spook him. And it's like, then you'll be telling a story. Yeah, I was sitting on my horse and for no reason, he just ran and started bucking and he threw me. The horse is crazy. Oh, you're a freaking idiot. Stop it. Quit blaming a horse, freaking crybabies.
You can't see.
See the pressure? He's getting draw pressure right now. I want to see. I want to look. I want to look. What does he do? Did you hear the, I don't know if you guys can hear that. Ransom called him trying to get me in freaking trouble. I should have got off and beat Ransom. I shouldn't have got off.
Make him stand for a second.
I don't know if you can hear that. Go to the video. You can hear right here. Ransom calls him. And Buddy's like, oh, what's going on? He wants my partner. I need to go save him. And he took his attention off me. Ransom wasn't calculating and thinking, I'm going to get Buddy, and who's this guy to take my friend? Ransom was just like, I kind of miss my herd mate. He's kind of away from me. I'm in here. I want to let him know I'm here. I'm okay. I'm still with him. They were just talking. There wasn't any malicious intent on any of these horses. Even when Buddy bucked, it wasn't like, I hate this guy. I'm going to throw him. I'm going to hurt him. I'm going to try and kill him. It wasn't. It was him saying no. And the only way he could say no, I don't really want to run. You made me run. I don't feel comfortable. This is the first time I ran. Maybe he's just filling his oats.
He can't see Ransom. He wants to look at Ransom. He needs to look at me. I'm going to make him flex. Make him flex that other side.
So people.
He wants to walk off.
People were asking why I was flexing a horse. When you flex a horse like this, some people will say it makes your horse supple, which it does, kind of like stretching my back before I get out or stretching my leg. If you stretch a little bit, it makes your movement easier. So I'm stretching his neck left and right, loosening up his muscles, but he's also following my request with the reins. When I pick up the rein, I want him to give the pressure. Me picking up the rein is pressure. He should release pressure when I give him pressure. I give pressure. He releases pressure. When he touches his head around, I drop the rein, he gets release. He knows when this guy picks up the rein, if I touch my head, he'll stop pulling on the rein. In his mind, in order to get this dummy to stop pulling on the rein, I have to flex my head. It's not the right answer for him. I've taught him it's the right answer to get release. Remember, make the right thing easy. I want him to know how to get released. That's why when you're loud and nagging and pulling and stop and keep your head straight, don't look over there, and your horse just gets in a fight and he starts ignoring all your pressure because he doesn't know what the right answer is. He doesn't know how to get you to stop tearing his face off with a bit or pulling or causing. He doesn't know the answer. So he learned helplessness and he says, screw it. I'll just ignore it and do what I think she wants me to do and whatever. All right.
Make him flex that other side. He wants to walk off. Backing up.
Now, when he's backing up right here, I made it seem like he was doing it intentionally. He was confused. He just didn't know what I wanted. I wasn't being clear because we haven't ridden enough and I haven't done the ritual that we flex. He was like, I'm feeling pressure on this side. And because I ride him with one rein sometimes so I can control him in case my reins break or whatever, I can ride with one rein. This is how I would control him, one rein. When I stop him, I would pull back. But normally when I want him to flex, I pull up and over. He feels it on his neck and I pull up, and that means drop your head and just flex. If I want him to back up, I will pull back and kind of brace a little bit and then pull it to where I brace his head straight instead of breaking his head at the neck. So when I'm talking about bracing, if I pull my horse with two reins straight back, I kind of brace the neck. He can't turn. If I use one rein and kind of pull it this way, I kind of help him turn his head a little bit. So when I'm picking up the rein here, I want him to flex. Even though I'm pulling from here, I'm pulling on one rein. I want him to flex this way. If I want him to back up, I would just kind of put pressure here until he released it. But it takes finesse, and you have to do it slowly in order to get it. It doesn't happen if you're always yanking and pulling on the reins. Oh, buddy fell. He'll be all right.
I don't want him backing up. I want him to flex. He's guessing.
When I say he's guessing, he was guessing, but he was frustrated and he wasn't listening. He wasn't paying attention. If he was paying attention, as soon as he missed the first backup and I didn't release pressure, he'd have went, he wants a flex. But because he wasn't paying attention and just trying things, I'll just back up. Okay, I'll back up again. I don't know what. I want to eat. I want to look at Ransom. I want to do. His mind was so busy. I go back to the samurai, The Last Samurai. I love that movie. I know I'm not a big Tom Cruise fan, but I love that movie. I thought he did a great job. In there, the guy tells him when he's fighting with another guy, too many minds. And he goes, too many minds. He says, yes, mind on other people, mind on this, mind on that. He goes, one mind, you and your opponent. When you're on a horse, you need one mind, you and your horse. Not talking to camera, not trying to look cool, not trying to get points, not trying to impress the judges, not trying to do all 10 different things, not answering your phone, texting, doing all, not, too many minds. When you're working a horse, you want to be focused on the horse, you and him. So neither one of you miss nothing. Vice versa, you want the horse focused on you. You don't want Buddy focused on the pasture and Ransom and talking to Ransom and maybe eating and looking away and not paying attention. Too many minds for Buddy. I had too many minds because I'm talking to the camera and not doing it completely with him. So he's like, I'm not doing it complete with him either. I'm going to look around, eat some grass, etc.
Listening and paying attention. He's guessing. I don't want him guessing.
I still have the dinosaur, by the way, and it's still sitting in the garage, but I haven't done it yet. Both the boys are out there eating now in the wet grass. What happened? Did I like mute this? Oh, shit. I didn't even know I muted it.
Let's do the moonwalk. Woo-hoo-hoo! But let's walk off.
Now, when I said walk off, did you see how I told Buddy to walk off? Let's watch Buddy walk off.
But let's walk off.
You notice that I gave him several cues to walk off. I didn't tell him walk. That's another cue that I give sometime. But I lean forward. I move my reins forward. I create slack. My whole body does a forward movement. And you can't see it, but my legs gave a very slight squeeze. It was almost like I pushed my legs forward like I was pushing him forward. But it was very, very light. So Buddy felt my legs. He felt my body. And my hand went forward. Everything said move forward, and he walked off almost like he knew what I wanted, because he did know what I want. But a lot of people will see that and not know that. Watch the changes in my body when I want him to go forward.
Well, let's walk off.
Very slight clues. That's what's happening. A lot of people might not see that. Some people don't explain it like that. I don't have to kick. I hate the kickers. The guys with the loud legs, their legs are always kicking and bouncing and trying to, you got to use your legs. I use my legs and you didn't see anything. Okay. Difference between idiots and finesse.
We're going to turn a little bit here.
He wanted to go to Buddy and stop. You didn't see it, but I gave him a little pressure to keep turning. Right here, he was going to stop and face Ransom because that's what he wanted to do. I gave him very, very little pressure because I always want to use the least amount of pressure that I can to get a horse to do something. I never want to be loud, strong, hard all the time. My goal is to always get my horse to do the same thing with me doing less. So right here, when he wanted to stop, I just moved the reins a little bit, and you can't see, I gave him a little bit more leg, like, don't stop. So my legs kind of squeezed, and they weren't squeezing before, and he felt it. And he's like, oh, he doesn't want me to stop. And because he knows and we're communicating, I didn't have to do the leg bouncing. Keep walking. Keep those legs kicking sperm. You got to let him know you want him to move. I didn't have to do any of that. Watch very lightly how I made him move. He wants to stop. Watch his stop. Pause. I gave him a little pressure, and he kept going. Did you see where he kind of said no there? Who picked up that movement? How did Buddy tell me no on that turn? Let's go to the comments here. It takes me a few seconds because I'm 10 seconds. Horse born witch. I like to squeeze too. I like when girls squeeze. I like when girls squeeze too. All right. So how did Buddy tell me no or give me pressure on that turn? Who saw it? Ears? I didn't see the ears. That's not what I was going to say, but you may be correct. I missed it. Let's go back. He pinned his ears back. That's not what I was looking. Head movement and body movement is what I saw. His head went up and he picked up his pace, kind of like, all right, darn it, I'll do it. I didn't ask him to speed up. Watch his body change when he does this. So right here, he wanted to stop. I told him no and gave him pressure. You didn't see it. Ears are kind of like, I kind of want to stop. Ears went forward. I gave him more pressure, and I picked up this rein ever so lightly to get him to turn to the direction I wanted. See that head movement? Right here, his pace changes, kind of like, I didn't really want to turn, but I will. Very slight. Watch it. Right here. Picks up pace. See that head kind of, he got a little bit bigger and wanted to go faster. And then I picked up the reins and says, don't take off on me.
Bring back the camera.
But he's not relaxed. look, his head is not low. He is not relaxed. Ransom's in the background getting a fly off his belly. I probably should have sprayed his belly down. I didn't. But he's getting a fly off his belly. If you see him, he's not out there saluting Buddy or, hey, Buddy, look at me. I'm standing on three legs. I'm a three-legged horse. Ha, ha, ha. He's not doing any of that. He's getting a fly off his belly in the background. All right, here we go.
So,
Buddy didn't want to eat there. Who thinks Buddy wanted to take a bite? Raise your hand. He wasn't trying to take a bite. He wanted to see if I was going to hold his head up and if he could move his head, if he wanted to take a bite, if I was going to stop him. He basically takes the reins out of my hands. Watch this. So my hand went forward because I could have been a pain in the butt, show and lose boss. Don't you pull that head. Don't you make my hand move. My heart, I give him release. I don't want to get in a fight with him. If he wants to eat, I don't care. He went down there, sniffed some grass, didn't even eat. But he got his way. Some people will say that was a mistake. I told him that he didn't have to listen to me. I let him do something without me telling him. I created the problem because I didn't stop him from doing what he wanted to do. There's some validity in that, but only if it's a big deal to you that you have to control your horse every second of every time you're around him. To me, it's not a big deal. Somebody may say if you hadn't let him know that, he probably wouldn't have bucked. Okay, it's easy to predict shit that you can't prove, but whatever. Maybe he wouldn't have bucked if I wouldn't let him do it. Maybe if I had him in a robot, he probably wouldn't have bucked. I've ridden horses with trainers that are robot trainers, and if you relax on that freaking horse for a second, they will freak out, panic. It's new to them, and it's bad news. That's why I tell people don't take your horse to a trainer unless you're there and you're training with them, because if the trainer is training the horse for how they ride, when you ride, that horse is going to be like, I don't have to listen to you. It's different. I don't like it. It's new. I'm spooky. I got my horse back from the trainer. He did everything perfect for the trainer, Rick. And when I got him, he wouldn't listen to me. Well, no shit. That's why you shouldn't send a trainer, because you don't know what you're doing. Rick, you're just mean. I came to you for help and you just yelled at me. Shut up, freaking crybabies. If you'd listen, you would know. You would be asking stupid questions.
So
he didn't eat and he picked his head up alone. Could I have taken that personally? He made me move my hand and act like he wanted to eat. He didn't even want to eat. He's just messing with me. If you want to fight with your horse, you can fight with your horse. People that are always complaining, my horse fights. My horse is hard. My horse pulls. My horse is this. I just look at him like, you don't get it. It's you, you big dummy. A horse is a reflection of you. Quit blaming a horse for being a horse. That's all they know how to be.
He's okay right now. He's still a little antsy and wants to go, but I gotta expect that. I haven't ridden him in a year. But let's go out to pasture here. I'll leave the camera there and see how he does. Good boy. Nice flex. That's back up. That's not a flex. That's what I wanted. So we gotta work on his flex a little bit.
I got 345 people. Hi, horsey people. I didn't know how many people. Shit, my last live only had like 190 or something. Maybe everybody's here. See, I was going to do a little clip. This is how my little mind works. Just to trick people, I was going to label like evaluating some dummy that doesn't know how to ride and made his horse buck. And then I was going to do this evaluation of me. And people would come here just to see who really knew what channel they were on. Because they'd be like, yeah, that guy was bad. And yeah, he is a jerk. And I was just going to crack on myself and do an evaluation of me and point out all kind of stupid shit on me and see how many crazy comments I got. Rick, why do you do that to people? Whatever.
I want a couple of good flexes before he's in routine.
I want you to notice these flexes. This is the way I like a horse to flex. Very responsive, very clear communications, very no pausing. It's like, I got it, Dad. I know what you want. His head movements were very quick. It was before I was getting a, do you want me to back up? Do you want me to do this? I wasn't getting on these flexes. It was like, I got it. Yeah, I got it. Left, right. Yeah, I got it. I got it. I know what I'm doing. That's when I know that he's connecting more. Was he 100% connected? No. Did I think he was going to be a golden boy after over a year? Somebody asked me if I've ridden him since Tanner died. I don't think I have. So Mr. T died and I don't think I've ever ridden him because I didn't want to ride him right after Mr. T died. He was trying to adjust. He had Ransom here. I think this is the first time I've ridden him without Mr. T. Did that affect it? Somebody said he may have been smelling Mr. T on the saddle pad. Maybe. I don't know. Does that change anything about me? It may make me feel good. It may make me feel sorry for him. It may evoke some emotions. But does it change how we interact? No, it doesn't. It doesn't change a damn thing. So even though this is the first time I rode him without Mr. T, could that have affected him a little bit? Maybe. I always say, I don't care why something happens. I want to either prevent it, understand it, stop it, train it away, know why, you know, how do I deal with it? That's why all these people who get these horses, and you get all these horror stories. This horse tried to kill this person. This horse is really bad. Be careful. This horse doesn't like women. This horse doesn't like men. And you get all this bullshit, and you have this in your mind, and you start changing the way you train because of what you know. I don't care what a horse, I don't care. I care what a horse does. And a horse doesn't care what you know and how great you are and how many ribbons you have on your wall. They only care what you do with them in the moment. And that's how I think good horse people react with horses. Just do what you do. Stay with the fundamentals. Build a house on solid ground and not in sand. People that are always changing and trying to adjust. And I had a psychic tell me that my horse doesn't like this. And he's got this. And he needs a chiropractor. And he needs, and they've got all these excuses on why they have to do things different. And it always fails. And they got all these excuses on why it failed. Just do what you do and do it right. Be clear with the horse. Be fair with the horse. It'll work out. All right. Let me get Gutter Girl off there from chewing people out. So I want you to watch these flexes.
There you go. We got to work on his flex a little bit. I want a couple
good flex
to where he's in routine. There
good flex.
That head when I asked for it. There you go.
Good flex. No leg movement, no confusion. Do you want me to back up? Should I remember earlier he was like, man, neck was stiff. Do you want me to back up? Maybe I will flex. Maybe I. These are good flexes. This is a good checklist on my check that I got his mind at least a little bit. Do you ever have it 100%? No. You know, a plane crash. Right now, if a plane crashed in my pasture behind me that I didn't know, but he would spook, run off, maybe buck, and I might fall off. I might be able to stay on. There would be a reaction. I can't plan for that. Rick, if you got a good horse, it wouldn't matter. I don't give a shit who you are. If a plane crashes in your area when you're on a horse, your horse is reacting. So when you plan that you think your horse is all great and it's never going to react, that's when you get caught and you end up falling off your horse and blaming your horse for throwing you.
So that's what I want. That's getting in his mind. That's telling him.
So because ever since I got on that horse and I pulled, I kind of readjusted the saddle a little bit. And I'm always checking my saddle. I want the center line. I want the center of my rear saddle and the center of his back. And I want this horn centered on his shoulders. And I'm kind of anal about it. So when you see me doing that, if I see that saddle a little off, and I might have been throwing it off because my hip was hurting and I was subconsciously not putting pressure on my left hip, which was making me lean away from the pressure of my pain in my hip, and I kept moving the saddle a little off balance. So every time I looked down and the saddle wasn't right, I was like, shit, why is it doing that? When I was doing it, I probably wasn't connecting. As I'm watching it, it's because I was in pain and I was trying to avoid the pain and I was leaning right, which was pulling my saddle right. And that's why you keep seeing me adjust it to the left and I didn't connect it because I was talking to you and trying to pay attention to Buddy and et cetera. I had too many minds going on. Does anybody ever see my heels kick my horse? You shouldn't. You might be able to go find a video. I don't like that unless I was demonstrating that I don't like it. When I see loud heels, I always just get it. It's just a visceral reaction. This person's an idiot. They don't get it. If you have to control your horse by doing this shit on their ribs all the freaking time, you can't ride. Sorry. Rick, I do that and I can ride. I got a lot of ribbons and you're just being mean. And you know, well, I'm just telling you, quite horse people or good horse women, horse men, whatever you want to call it. When they're quiet, their hands are quiet. Their legs are quiet. Their mouth is quiet. The horse acts like they're doing things and it's hard for you to tell how they're making the horse listen to them. That's good horsemanship. In my opinion, not the end of the world. If you want to kick your horse, I don't really care. It's not my horse. I might crack on you and call you a dummy, but whatever. Okay, so I don't know if Buddy, some people know. I talk about this test a lot, which I really thought was a great test. They put these, probably women, I don't even know. I'd have to go back and look at the test. I think I put the test on my website, but my guess is it was women. Rick, why are you? I'm just because a lot of women do these tests. There's a lot of women in the horse world. The horse world is dominated by women, etc. Anyway, I'm just going to say women because I know it'll piss off the little rice paper filling women and they'll get their feelings hurt. Most people will be like, whatever, who cares if it's woman or man? He's just being a smart ass. All right, whatever. But I'll say it anyway because I like irritating them. So they put these women in an arena and they had a guy standing there with a fire hose. And they had heart monitors on the rider, women, and the horse, man or mare, whatever. And they had heart monitors on both. And they told the people, you're going to walk around this arena. And when you get to the guy with the hose, he's going to squirt you and your horse with a hose. Be ready. So the riders thought they were going to get squirted with a hose. Guess what? They were tense. They reacted. Their body changed. They were relaxed around as they're walking. And as they got closer to the fire hose, their heart rates went up. They didn't know it. They weren't doing it intentionally, but anxiety was building because they thought they were going to get squirted with a fire hose. Well, guess what? When the rider's heart rates went up, the horse's heart rate went up. I thought that was a brilliant exercise and a great study and a scientific fact that horses respond and can read the rider. Some people will interpret that as horses know when you're scared. Horses can smell fear, Rick. I don't think horses smell fear. They may be able to see it through your actions, your stiffness. They may be able to hear it in your voice. And they may be able to feel it in your body if you're on them, but I'm not sure they smell it. I could be wrong. There'll be some smell expert telling me I don't know what I'm talking about, but whatever. This experiment, every rider that went by, their heart rate shot up because they thought they were going to get squirted with a hose, and their horse's heart rate went up also. That tells you that. Now, somebody just said, Buddy knew you were hurting. I don't know if he knew I was hurting. If my heart rate was up because I was in pain, if I was riding to the left and favoring the left, he probably picked up something's not right, something's off, I'm not used to this. He might have picked that up, but did he know I was in pain? I don't think I'm there. When he sees me walk with a limp, does he think I'm hurt or does he think I'm in pain? I think when a horse sees another horse limping, they're like, hey, he's not at 100%. I can probably take him. He used to be higher than me, but I think I can push him around now. I think they may see it like that, but do they have the effort to say that horse is in pain because he's limping and I'm going to capitalize on that pain? I don't think horses have that ability, but I could be wrong. It's just me. All right. What TF do you? I'm sorry. Mom, I don't know if English is your first language or if you're typing kind of funny, but I have no clue what that is. Sorry. They expected something wrong and was ready to spawn. Absolutely. And that's why nervous riders make nervous horses. Loud hands make loud horses. High hands make high heads. It's all what you do. Nervous riders make nervous horses because their heart's rate up, because they have their helmet on, because they have their bulletproof vest on, and they think they're safe, but they're nervous, and they're expecting a horse to fall off, and they have to be careful because they don't want to crack their head, and horses are dangerous, and he may run off, and I have to keep my reins tight so he doesn't run off, and he may buck, so I have to be ready. Nervous riders make nervous horses. A horse is a reflection of the rider. When I see nervous horses, I see nervous riders. Even though they want to tell you how empowered, how strong, how wonderful, how confident, how they got ribbons. Even though they give you the greatest resume in the world, I can look at their horse and tell what kind of rider they are. Sorry. Rick, you just ain't women and you're always. But he's the all horses are human whispers. They absolutely know what we're doing, why we're doing it. The old trick, I'm going to hide the halter behind my back. I'm going to sneak up on a, it ain't going to happen. I tell that story where I tried to sneak up on Mr. T's herd and he almost killed me. I mean, he was such a great horse. I thought I was going to die, but I was so proud of him. I was sneaking up. It was at night and he was out there with a bunch of mamas and there was a few babies and he was on his, normal stallion. I'm going to be Mr. T. Nobody's going to get my herd or my babies, even though they weren't even his babies. He just, he was the herd leader. And I come sneaking up and the baby saw me first and let out a little warning. I can't mimic it because it was a little deeper growl kind of whinny or communication. And as soon as I saw, when the baby saw me and it made that little noise, and I ducked behind a bush. But it was so instinctual for Tanner to just freaking go into freaking aggressive mode. He turned. He knew exactly where the baby was looking. He looked where I was at that bush. I was still hitting. I don't think he smelled me, but he came charging that freaking bush like a maniac. And I was like, holy shit, he's going to kill me. I'm like, Tanner, Tanner. I started backing away. I stood up, and he got really close right before he stopped and went, oh, it's you, you big dummy. You almost died. I mean, it scared the shit out of me, but it was a great feeling to see what a great dad and herd leader he was. I miss that horse. Okay, I've cracked on a lot of people for riding underneath there. You should never ride a horse like this. If he rears right now, he's going to break my neck, break my back. This is not a good move. I knew it was going to be short. I did it. I wasn't even really comfortable doing it. Even though I knew my horse, I was still a little uncomfortable doing this. But I was like, my legs hurt, and I'm not getting off and walking it. Remember, I took the easy way. The easy way is not the right way. I should have got off and walked him through there, or I should have went through a gate that didn't have something. So somebody's going to watch this and say, this guy doesn't know what he's doing. He's dangerous. He's cracked on other people. I get it. I know it was wrong. I took the chance. I did it with full knowledge. I wasn't doing it because I was stupid, thinking nothing could happen, and I just did it as a matter of routine. There is a difference. This was not a good move, and I did not really even feel comfortable. Even though I trust Buddy a lot, I just didn't feel comfortable doing it, because if something went wrong, I was screwed, and my head was going to get beat by these rafters. Not a good move, but I did it. Whatever.
I don't like this little trot off that he just did there. I can normally, I would ignore that and let him do his little thing, but I'm trying not to get him to buck. So that little trot off tells me I didn't ask you.
Remember when I say when a horse tells you no, a lot of people think it's clear on the no. They're hurting you or trying to do something. That's not the case. Okay? His no to me right here.
Trot.
Right here, did you hear Ransom talk to him? Listen closely, you'll hear Ransom. So Ransom talked to him, and he immediately went, I'm high horse. I've got to show my horse. I can't show submissive, or he may not think I'm high horse. So he may have been responding to Ransom a little bit. It didn't matter. I want him to respond and pay attention to me. See that little prance, that high head, that I want to go faster? I had to pick up the rein and say, hey, slow down. Pay attention. I'm here. Listen to me. That's what I was doing when I pick up that rein. Watch this, pick up this rein.
Okay, so I don't like this little trot off that he just did there. Normally, I would ignore that and let him do his little thing.
And that's normally what I do. I let Buddy be Buddy. If he goes out there and does that shit, I'm like, whatever. Do what you got to do. Let's ride. We'll get used to it. Okay? I mean, I rarely run my horse rapidly if I go out for a ride. I usually saddle him up. We get on the trail. I'm exposing the area. We have to go through a gate. We're kind of observing the area, looking around. We're doing normal horse riding things, and I'm just not in the mood for a canter. You should never canter down an unknown trail. When I go out trail riding and go somewhere to ride, I don't know the trails. You would never want to run your horse on a trail you don't know. There may be a ditch. There may be a piece of wood. There may be nails. You don't know. You don't run your horse on a trail you don't know. People that do that are irresponsible, setting a horse up to fail. It's just bad horsemanship. You don't do that. I know my pasture. I know its level. I go out there. I'm doing it for the video. I don't want to just walk around and have people watch me walk around. I wanted to see if I get a response, and I wanted him to canter and see if I could get him to canter without bucking. He threw one buck on the first one. He threw a couple bucks on the next one. Not the end of the world.
I'm trying not to get him to buck. So that little trot off tells me I didn't ask you to trot.
Why didn't you correct him under the shed for trotting off? Too dangerous with rope. Well, he didn't trot off until we left the shed. I wouldn't want to bring him back to the shed to correct him. I mean, I didn't even like walking through it once. You notice the second time I got here, I dismounted out here. I didn't ride him out here and dismount because I didn't want to go through the shit again. Right here, I'm just kind of controlling his feud. I'm walking him to Ransom. I'm moving Ransom out of the way. I'm making him circle Ransom. See, sometimes instead of preventing a horse from going to what he wants, take him to what he wants and make him work. Horses like to get back to the barn because when you get back to the barn, you get off your horse, you unsaddle him, and he gets to go in a stall, and that's what he wants. If you went back to the barn and worked your horse and did round pens and stopping everything, your horse wouldn't be that excited to get back to the barn because he knew he'd be going back there to work. In this case, he wanted to get to Ransom. I made him go to Ransom, and I moved his feet. I made him circle Ransom. I made him push Ransom. I controlled and communicated with him and controlled his feet around Ransom. If you want to be with Ransom, I'll let you go be with Ransom. But I'm going to control your feet when you're with him. You're not going to be with him. He thinks if I'm with Ransom normally, I get to be in charge. I'm a horse. Ransom, listen to me. We go off and we do horsey shit all day, and we don't have to deal with humans. That's not going to happen when I'm on your back. So I just reinforced that by moving Ransom. Some people thought I was being mean to Ransom. He was limping. I was trying to hurt him. You know, there's all these. Everybody's going to assign their own filter to what they see. So I wanted to back Ransom up here and make Ransom back up. I think Ransom kind of hurt in arthritis. He doesn't like to back up, but he turned away instead. I wanted Buddy's head to block him off right here and block his ability to turn, and I didn't do it correctly. So that was my fault that Ransom, it wasn't Buddy's fault. I wanted to block him right here, and I let them get their heads around each other. I wasn't close enough to block Ransom's head and then move into him and back him up. So that was my fault that Ransom didn't back up. Again, we define what the right answer is and what we want, but unless we can communicate it and effectively make it happen with the horse, it's our fault it didn't happen. This isn't a horse issue that Ransom didn't back up when I wanted him to back up and I was trying to get Buddy to back up. I didn't put Buddy in the right position and control Buddy in order to make Ransom back up. That's what good horsemanship is, accepting that it's your fault when it doesn't go right, not the horse's. So the big thing I wish people would get when they'd watch me ride is my hand movements are usually very smooth. They're not yike, jerky. I'm never yanking my horse's head around except when he bucked. My hands are quiet, but he's quiet. Even with his head up here and he's a little excited, I don't want to, oh, you got to be quiet. I got to adjust your head. I ignore it unless he does something that I think is too egregious. If he started following him right now, I would stop that. But him looking and get his head out and telling me, Buddy's telling me right now, I want to go with Ransom. I want to be with him. Why is he leaving? He's creating anxiety. Why are you letting him get so far? I don't let him get that far. Anxiety's building in Buddy right now. Guess what? I don't care. It's not because I want to be mean. I want him to listen to me. I want things to try and distract him and get him to make a mistake. Most people aren't going to say, you should never want your horse to make a mistake. I want him to do things so I can effectively correct it without becoming a fight and say, no, you can't walk off. No, you can't follow him. No, you need to stand here. No, you need to back up when I tell you. You need to flex when I tell you. You need to pay attention to me. When I'm on you, it's me and you. It's not you and horsey world. So that's why when I create sometimes things that create distraction, people think, man, you're stupid. You should have never done that. You should never do that. You shouldn't go. I mean, I can't tell you the number of times I'd be dragging a trash can because a lot of times I'd have Buddy drag shit. One, because it's good practice for him in case I had to pull a log or drag a horse or move something. Two, everyone else would get freaking pissed because their horses couldn't handle it. Because all their horses would respond to my horse dragging something. And they would be like, don't do that around. And though you're scaring the horses. Horses would be like, oh shit, there's something behind that horse. He's going to attack them. And the horses would get jacked up. And I'd be like, it's good for them to see that. It's good for them to see a horse walking calmly dragging something. Maybe they will learn that I don't have to run and go into flight mode when something's behind me. But that's not how all the crazy barn witch horsewomen saw it. they saw it as I was being dangerous and I was ruining their horse and I was making their horse reactive and they couldn't ride because I was having something behind my horse because everyone else should do everything for you because you can't ride your horse and everybody else needs a modify. I don't give a shit what you do with your horse when I'm out there. If you do something that scares my horse, I'm like, good. I'm probably going to follow you around so you can scare him again because I want to deal with the issue so my horse knows. A horse is going to respond instinctually until we teach him that he doesn't have to respond. And we do that by getting to ignore his instincts. Horses are the masters of desensitizing. People be like, my horse is scared of the wind. They're scared of the birds. They're scared of tractors. They're scared of big trucks. They're scared of this. They're scared of that. Horses are masters at accepting new things. They have to. Their life depends on it. Imagine if a horse was born and every time he saw something, a wind blow, a leaf blow by, he reacted and ran. He wouldn't have time to eat. He would always be nervous. He would use up all his calories. He would be scared all the freaking time. Couldn't have babies. Couldn't reproduce. Couldn't be a part of the herd. He would just be running from everything in his environment all the time. They don't do that or they would be dead and be extinct. They are masters at accepting scary things. People want to make them think, oh my God, not my horse. No, I have to protect him. I can't do it. They are masters at desensitizing and accepting scary things. They're great at it. They have to be good at it. They may not be good at it with you. You may not be able to make them good at it. You may make it worse, but they're perfect in their own. You can put a horse out in pasture and they look at all kinds of shit. They look at planes fly by. They look at eagles. They look every once in a while, a bag will fly by. It'll spook them. They'll run a little bit. They'll look at it. But if there's bags in a pasture, they're not going to stop eating. They're not going to be scared for the rest of their life and not eat. Eventually they will go, I got to accept it. Bag's going to be there. Tie a tarp to your fence. It flaps all the time. Guess what? Your horse may not go around it for a couple days. In a few days, he'll be going around and ignoring it. Won't matter. He knows how to adjust. I don't want to protect my horse from things that make him react. I want to expose him to things that'll make him react so I can deal with it and teach him he doesn't need to react. When you avoid it, I tell the train story. All those women out riding, that woman told me a story. They were out and one lady goes, man, if a train comes by, my horse is really scared. And all the other women was like, my horse is scared of trains too. Mine too. If a train comes, we need to get out. All of a sudden, a freaking train came. And one girl yelled, train! And took off running with her horse as fast as she could. And all the other horses panicked because they saw this horse run away. And they all ran away and the train came by. They all just taught their horses to be scared of trains. I was like, you got to be shitting me. Did that really happen? And the girl was like, yep. And she knew. She was like, I wanted my horse to kind of stand there and kind of do it. But when all the other women took off and my horse saw all their horses running, I knew there's no way my horse was going to stay and I'd get in a big fight next to the train. So I just ran with them. Not a great move on her part, but at least she realized what a dumb move that was and the bad lessons they taught all those horses that it was okay to see a train. And if you see a train, you should run. It's just crazy sometimes the stories I hear.
Breathing is a little elevated.
Now, his breathing's elevated, I think, because I haven't ridden him a while. He's in pasture. His buddy's walking away creating stress, but it may be elevated a little bit because I'm in pain and my heart rate's up. Maybe he's feeding off me and he's misinterpreting my high heart rate as I'm insecure. I'm nervous. Maybe I see a threat. What's going to happen next? Why is his heart rate up? Maybe. See, a lot of times we can say things that we know what's going on, but it's kind of an educated guess. If you can get a lot of good predictions, you can probably assume that you're guessing right, but you could be wrong.
I can tell he's a little tense.
Because I said this, a lot of people said you should have got off. You should have lunged him. You should have done that. I had all this advice on what I should have done because I knew that he wasn't relaxed. Therefore, I shouldn't have rode him. If that's how you want to handle it, then do it that way. That's not the way I handle it. So I kind of walked him off here. You notice his tail now? Notice his tail is hanging freely. He's relaxed. He's going with his buddy. He's going where he wants to go. I'm not making him do something he doesn't want to do. Tail hanging nice and relaxed. I can't see that. I can see it now. Remember before I told you his tail was up? That's another sign that he was irritated. When you're on the ground with your horse, that's what reading a horse is, noticing that head position, that bowing up, the quick gait, the startled gait, the threatening to kick, the tail up, the ears back, the ears not paying attention, the head looking away. All those things are just basic body movements that you learn over time that it becomes second nature. Somebody goes, what do you mean the horse did that? I didn't see anything. Well, I saw it because I know horses. I'm not saying I'm an expert and I know everything, but I know horses. So here, this prancing, this is a kind of jog, walk, quick canter, whatever, half canter, halfway. There's all kind of names, I'll do it, whatever. He's not walking and he's not running. So you can call it what you want. But he's still releasing energy. Notice his tail is up here. I don't know if you can see it, but his tail is up here. More anxiety. His head is high. More anxiety. Maybe more no. Maybe more fear. Maybe more resistance. Maybe more I'm not comfortable. Maybe you're off center. Why are you leaning to the left? You're throwing me off balance. Maybe if and butsy coconuts, there could be a million things on why this is going on. I interpret this as he's not paying attention to me. I don't really care about all those other if and butsy coconuts. Doesn't really matter. What I want to get is, he's not paying attention to me and he's still kind of being an individual and he wants to do his own thing. That's what I'm working on. Now, I don't think I ask him to trot on any of this. This is all his own. Some people are of the mindset, you never let a horse do what he wants on his own because then you teach him he can't, he doesn't have to listen. I'm kind of like, if he wants to go through this, I know I can stop him when I want to. He's going to stop when I ask him to. I'll let him get some piss and vinegar out and think he's doing that because I know I'm confident that it ain't a big deal. Somebody that's not so confident may be like, oh my God, now I've lost all confidence and I don't know if I can stop him and I better get off. I'll do an emergency dismount. I'll get off and I'll run him in a round pen. I just won't ride him today. He's not ready to be ridden. He doesn't like it. Today's not a good day to ride because he's telling me he doesn't want to be ridden. I tell a story about that rescue place. They had big signs. Shh, only whispers. These horses don't like talking. You can only whisper. I was like, you got to be shitting me. You got an entire rescue. You're saying you're rescuing horses and you don't want people talking around horses because it scares them. What the hell is going to happen when somebody talks around a freaking horse? They're going to freak out. They've never heard anybody talk because the only thing they hear is. So they get used to that. And that's their normal now. You've readjusted their new normal to. So when somebody like me comes around and go, hey, horsey, they're like, what the holy shit? And then they're going to blame me. Man, you're crazy. You can't talk around these horses. You got to whisper. They're scared of loud noises. I was just like, you guys are a bunch of freaking idiots. But whatever. Maybe he did hear a train. I don't know. Guess what? I don't care. It doesn't matter. Maybe he was abused as a baby. Maybe his mom weaned him too early. Maybe his mom was too rough on him. Maybe he had a tough childhood. Maybe he was bullied by other horses. Maybe. I don't give a shit. Doesn't matter. Deal with the problem. Stop trying to analyze and guess because you really don't know. You're not ever going to know. So don't give a shit about a horse's past and what somebody did and how he was trained. I can untrain just as quick as I can train. I can teach a horse to buck. I can teach him not to buck. I can teach a horse to listen. I can teach a horse to fight. I can teach a horse to follow me. I can teach a horse to run from me. It doesn't matter. I don't care about all the peripheral bullshit that people want to attach emotion to, mainly women. Rick, you can't say that. Emotions, it just doesn't matter. A horse cares what you do. Are you clear? Is he frustrated? Are you inconsistent and you make him frustrated? That's what causes horse problems. 99% of all horse problems are related back to people problems. It's not the horse. A horse is a horse. That's all they know how to be. Quit blaming them for being a freaking horse. I'm not saying you're saying that, Julie. I know you're being funny. I like big owls too. Let's see. A Okay, so here I was just kind of like walking around. I'm going to bounce it forward here. So this is where Mr. T was at. Did Buddy connect? Did Buddy sniff? Did Buddy feel sad? Did Buddy talk? I mean, what? I don't know. Did he grieve? Is this a touchy spot to ride him the first time by his buddy, his lifetime buddy for 20 years since he was a baby? In my mind, I don't think it affected a damn thing. I mean, we went over there. We kind of stopped. Did he smell him? Does he smell his decaying body over a year? I don't know. Again, it doesn't matter. People get so caught up in the whys instead of just dealing with what's in front of you and work the issue. Just... I didn't notice it here. I think he's taking a poop here, but I'm not sure. His tail was up. I think he was taking a poop. So when I walk out, I'm going to say I was out of range for maybe 5 minutes. I cut it out of the tape. And all I did is I walked the fence line. I walked up the pasture and I kind of walked around. I didn't do any trotting or running because I didn't want to wear. I mean, I could have went out of sight, ran the shit out of him, cut the tape out, come back in here, and then rode him up here fine and went, see, he never bucked. I'm a great horse trainer. That's not why I do these. I don't give a shit whether you think I'm great or good. I really don't. It doesn't matter. I'm confident in who I am as a horseman. So I just walked him. I wasn't trying to cheat or manipulate and try to make myself look good. Obviously, the horse bucked when I cantered him. It was the first time I cantered him. All right. So I came back in here. And I just walked through here. I did a little trotting here. I asked him to pick up a trot, and he trotted. And then when he bucks is when I kick him and say, canter. And when I say kick him, I didn't kick him. I just, when I tell my horse to pick up gates, I squeeze my legs. And I can even squeeze them. Instead of the legs doing this, my knees can do that very lightly, and you'll never see it. But I just told him, I gave him a click, and click means to trot, so he trotted. When I give him a kiss, he knows he's got to run. Because every time we run, I go, and I squeeze hard, and we take off in a run. So he knows if I don't have to squeeze now, when I just go, if I'm riding him enough, he jumps into a canter. Because he knows I'm going to squeeze him if he doesn't. When I want him to trot, I don't have to squeeze the legs. I just pick up my thing, give him a click, he goes into a trot. Because he knows click means trot, kiss means canter. So right here, when you see him buck, I kissed and we put him in the canter. Oh, I think I ended here. I got to go three. Sorry. Hang on. So we're at a walk. Anytime you go from a walk to a canter, you're more likely to get a reaction than if you go from a walk to a trot to a canter. I think I put him in, I told him to go to a canter from a walk. Even though he might have trotted a few steps before he got to it, he knew he was going for a run because he heard me kiss. Do you see the head? When I squeezed and told him to trot, that head was like, I don't want to. Watch very carefully. You'll know exactly when I changed because the horse changed. When you see his change, that's when I told him to canter because he said no. No. All right, I'll do it. You're not going to like it. Oh, I did trot him. Canter. I really love that horse, even though he's a butthead. I really love that horse. He's so stinking cute. I like sassy women, and I like sassy horses. I don't like robot freaking yes. I don't even like yes men. And when I was in the military, if I had guys kissing my ass, yes, sir, sergeant, no problem, yes, sir, sergeant, I didn't trust them. I like the guys that were kind of like, Man, come on, Sergeant Gore. Do we need to do that? That's kind of bullshit. Why? I'd rather those guys than the kiss asses. I just didn't trust kiss asses. So I don't like kiss ass men. I don't like kiss ass women. And I don't like kiss ass horses. All right. And Buddy doesn't kiss my ass, and neither did Mr. T. Rick, that's dangerous. You should wear a helmet. Whatever. He totally got me off guard. You can see here, and this is where I want to go over. See how my body's forward? If you notice on all buck riding, bronc riding, you get some images here of some bronc riding. What the hell did I put there? That's some freaking extra letters. You'll notice on all bronc riding or horse riding, where is their body weight? Back. You always want to be back on a buck. You notice that this guy is leaning back. When a horse gets you forward, you're usually going off. So anytime I expect a horse to buck, I normally adjust backwards and get my back ready to lay down. I call it laying down on their back. I basically want to lay down on this horse's back because that's going to keep me in a saddle. If my weight goes forward, I'm going off. In this picture, he's a little more vertical. This one, I'm assuming, is about to go off because he's forward. He is not leaning back. This is not a good position on a bucking horse. This picture, he's leaning back. You want to lean back. This picture, leaning back. That's what you want to do. You need to get your weight backwards. Buddy caught me. I was in an upright position, and I wasn't ready or leaning, and I was just going to, I leaned forward to push him into the canter, and when I leaned forward, he immediately threw that rear end up, and because I was already leaning forward, I went forward, and I'm telling you, man, I thought I was coming out. I luckily kind of fell back in the saddle and was able to collect his head a little bit and get him with my verbal. You'll notice an immediate change in him on no, and he was like, oh, shit, Dad's mad, and I want my horse, and the only time I use that really aggressive no is when I want to stop something dangerous or I want him to knock off what he's doing. If he's getting caught in a barbed wire, if he's playing in a barbed wire, if he's kicking a horse and I don't want him kicking, if he's being what I, you know, thinking is being too aggressive or something over food, I correct him and he knows that when I go, no, there's something else that's about to happen. Either I'm taking away his head, I'm picking up a rock and throwing it, I'm chasing his butt off with a rope. Something's going to happen when I say no. And I want him to think that, because now I can get a reaction that I want with just a verbal. You will notice an immediate change in Buddy's response when I yell. No. Go back. So I didn't yell no, I yelled quit. I don't go quit unless I want him to stop. I rarely yell. A quit is pretty much a correction for me. And I immediately went to my reaction of quit, quit. But you'll notice on the first buck, I'm forward. It's too late. Those back legs went in the air. That tail went up. Right here, you can see the tail. Back legs go up. I go up, and I am forward. Tail straight up in the air, and now I'm leaning forward. I'm toast. I mean, he just – I don't know if I can zoom in more on this. I can't. I don't know how to zoom on this. But you can absolutely see that tail and back legs on that first buck, and I'm leaning forward trying to get him to go forward. And he totally got me off guard with the first. Normally, he'll do a canter a little bit and then buck doing the canter. He tricked me to little shit and got the first buck in on the first canter, and I wasn't ready. So when those back legs went up and I was forward, I'm out of saddle here. And I am almost on his freaking neck. And I'm like, shit. And that's how I got this damn bruise. I don't know if you guys can see it. Nah, I can't see it. I don't want to jumble it. But it's still here. And I don't know how long ago this was. It's been over a week, but the bruise is still there. And that's where he got me, because that hip went into the horn. And I mean, I thought, oh, shit, he's going over. So I immediately collected the reins to try to like hug him a little bit so I could literally almost kind of push myself backwards into an upright position. And you'll see here where he's kind of, I'm going off to the right side. Why am I going off to the left side? I mean, why do you think I'm going off on the left side? Because my leg was hurting. It was my weak side. I didn't have the strength. It was the pain. And I couldn't correct and stay in the saddle. So that pain just went up my leg, and I tried to release the pain. When I released the pain, I moved more left. They got me more out of the saddle. So all this was happening so quickly, I couldn't think about it. Looking at it now, I know exactly what was going on. So he's so cute when he bucks. You got to love him. So I immediately tried to get upright, kind of take his head away, held his head straight back, tightness, gave him a no. That head was like, his head was a little bit like, oh shit, dad's upset. What do I do? He was releasing pressure because I was pulling and he was trying to release. And normally I'm not that hard. So it was very odd for him. Good. It should have been odd. He should have been freaking bucking. So I immediately made him back up, back up, back up, back up. This back up again, submissive. Horses don't like to back up. He can't see where he's backing up. Total thing is making him back up. And I got in the saddle and I was like, all right, shit. I mean, the power of the where he, that one little buck just threw me out of the saddle. I was like, man, that's freaking amazing. But anyway, so then I immediately kind of recollected, but it was over. There's no reason to keep beating him up, running him in circles, hitting him, telling him how bad he was. I adjusted my hat because his buck was so strong, it literally took my hat off. I mean, my hat was almost coming off. So I had to, you'll notice I had to pull my hat, my hat down immediately after the buck. I get him back. My hat's just flopping on my head. It's almost off. He almost bucked. And I have to collect my hat right here because my, I mean, it was a pretty hard buck. Okay. So after this, it was all verbal. I'm just talking smack, you know, to him. He got his correction. It's kind of over. Ransom came trotting in. Hey, what's going on? I wanted to flex him a little bit, take his head away, saying, you don't do that. Taking his head away is showing dominance. It's showing that he's not in charge. It's showing that he has to submit to me. It's showing that I can control his feet, stop him. I can take his head away. All that is me showing dominance over him, hopefully, so he won't want to push back and tell me no and show dominance over me when I tell him to run. It's all a communication. So somebody was telling me I should never run him back to the fence. That's very bad. That's like running back to the barn. Look, you people out there with all this great advice that have no videos, that probably can't ride, that ride in arena, coming here telling me how to ride, you kind of sound stupid. You definitely sound stupid to me. You may sound smart to other idiots, but to me, you sound pretty stupid. Me running this horse to the fence, it doesn't change a damn thing to me. He wants to go there. I need to get closer to the camera. The camera was there. I brought him back. Is it ideal to run your horse back to the barn and then get off him? No, because then he'll learn that I need to run back to barn because you get off. I didn't get off him. I ran him back to the area so I could talk on a camera. I wanted y'all to be able to see close enough and maybe hear me to do this demonstration. Everybody had to tell me on how smart they were and how dumb I was for running my horse back to the barn. Whatever. It's just nonsense, but it sounds good to the unknowing. Because when you don't know what you don't know, in the land of the blind, the man with one eye is king. There's a lot of people that sound like they got one eye and they can see. And there's a lot of people that are blind in the horse world, so they gravitate to the idiot with one eye. Okay?
Well, I guess he told me no.
So there was no real anger. I didn't hate him. It wasn't personal. He wasn't trying to kill me. I mean, ideally, I probably would have preferred if he didn't do it, but I kind of like when he challenged me and pushes back a little bit. He's a horse. I like having a horse that's a horse. I don't like robot horses. It wasn't a big deal for me.
I wasn't expecting that. I thought he did fine out there. That was the first time I ran him. So
on these little runs, I got a little more aggressive. You may have not seen it. But I wasn't the, let's just walk around and we'll have a nice walk and I'll control. That's not how I'm riding now. I got in his ass a little bit. You may not know it. My legs were a little bit stiffer. You better move out when I tell you. The reins, his head's higher. I was giving him a lot more control on his head. There wasn't this soft, I'm trying to be soft and we're trying to have a great communication. I'm being a little more aggressive. I'm not being mean. I wasn't doing it to punish him or to hurt him. I was doing it because I really wanted to be clear. Dude, you got to pay attention to me. I don't want this bullshit. We're not out here relaxing. You can't be a horse. You need to listen to me. And that's why if you see my hands a little louder, a little quicker, his movements are a little more jerky. It doesn't look smooth because I'm getting in his butt a little bit. So he's not starting to trot on his own here. I'm telling him to trot here. A couple of times before I told you he trotted off on his own. He's not making any decisions here. I'm making all the decisions here because he bucked me. And I want to say, you know what? We have to reestablish that you listen to me and don't tell me no. So I'm being much more assertive, aggressive, whatever, leader, however you want to explain it. There's a big difference between me riding him now and how I rode him at the beginning. You may not be able to see it. And you may think he's doing shit on his own, but he ain't. His head's higher. He's not relaxed now. Hear that kiss? I knew he was getting in a canter. You see where my right arm is? We call that a clue. That's on my night latch. Okay. I've talked about a night latch before. I'll pull up a picture. Otherwise, I'll forget. I put these on all my saddles. These are lifesavers. I did a video on me installing them on my saddle. They sell fancy ones. Sometimes I just tie a rope like this. It is basically an oh shit handle. Like in a car, they have a handle. If you're in a rough riding, you can grab that handle. This is an oh shit handle on your saddle. And it's usually wrapped around a horn and it's just a piece of leather. Again, I've got a video to where I installed it. It seems like they're making some really fancy ones now. These are nice, good, grippy ones. I've used an old dog collar for a night latch. You just run it through there to buckle. I don't like the buckle because if I have to grab it, I don't want to grab a buckle. The buckle will pinch. I don't like buckles around my horses. So I usually take the buckle off and use what's that damn pound rivet, I think is what it's called. But anyway, I did a video on me installing it on my saddle. So a night latch gives you that little handle when a horse is getting bucky. You see this guy's hand right here? Let's see if I can open this. If it gets bigger. See how he's got his hand right there? That keeps you in the saddle and it locks you in. It lets my arm right here lock my leg down in the saddle and he can't get me out as easy. And it holds me in a saddle. So it's called a night latch because when you're riding at night, you can't see. Your horse can see. I mean, when you ride at night, it's blind. It's pitch black. Your horse can see though. So if he stumbles or he jumps over a log or he does something and you're riding just normal, it's very easy to get thrown off balance or for him to spook and you fall off. If you're riding at night, you got a night latch, you grab that night latch. And then if your horse spooks or jumps, you stay in a saddle because you've got your hand latched on. Instead of latching onto the reins and the horse's face and maybe pulling him off, you latch onto the saddle and the night latch, and that holds you in your saddle. And when I was here, if you look in this video, my hand goes down to the right here, if you can see it, and I grab my night latch before I told him to run this time. Because if he bucked this time, I was going to be ready. I wasn't ready the first time. Usually I grab the night latch on a first canter. I got comfortable with him and I'm like, yeah, he's doing pretty good. He'll probably be all right. Probably. I love that commercial. Have y'all heard that commercial? Probably is the most misused word. Those two people are like, it's okay if we get a tattoo of each other's name on a first date. We'll probably stay together. That's a great line. So, okay. I got lax. I said, he'll probably be okay. I don't need to grab the latch. And I almost got my ass thrown off, which I'm sure a lot of people would have enjoyed. Some people would have felt sorry for me, but that's all right. Anyway, I'm grabbing the light latch here in case he bucked, but he did not buck. He went into a pretty good canter. He bowed a couple times, but he didn't buck. Ready? Let's for the kiss. So I kissed. You can hear the kiss in the video. He knew the canter. He went in a canter. He gave me a couple crow hops. I could tell his back roll. He bowed up a little bit on his back. I could feel it, even if you can't see it. So that's a precursor to a buck. And then you hear me say, quit. So somebody may not know, why did he tell him quit? Did he tell him to quit running? Did he tell him to quit? I was letting him know, I feel you bowing up, knock it off. So I'm going to turn the volume up, see if you guys can hear this. So I said, and then I went quit because he gave me that little, I'm feeling Bucky a little bit. And then I took him down to a canter. I controlled him. I controlled his feet. I stopped him. And now I'm laughing because I can tell he's telling me no again. He's like, dude, I don't want to run. Why are you making me run? I already tried to buck your ass off. And he just kind of bowed up on it a little bit, which again, I normally handle these things under saddle. Some people don't like handling problems under saddle. They want to get off. They feel more in control. They feel more safe. It probably is a little safer because you're less likely to get in trouble. I'm pretty comfortable in a saddle. I figure I can handle it. I've been bucked off many a time, so I'm not saying I'm an expert and I can always stay in a saddle, but I know Buddy and I'm just going to handle it in a saddle. So that's why you hear me laughing a little bit here. So he bucked a little bit. I can't remember if I ran him again or not. I stopped him, then I started him. So I trot him away and I canter him toward because I want you guys to see the response, and I'm coming closer to you and you can hear. That's why I'm doing it that way. Otherwise, I could have easily cantered him away from here. And everybody was saying, it's really bad. You're making him run back to the barn. You're going to teach him. You don't know what you're doing. You're crazy. Whatever. Freaking crazy. See my hand going down for that night latch? I don't know if you guys can see it. If you go back to the original video and you're on a big enough thing, it's kind of a cheat. You can watch him. My hand slides down to that night latch and go, I don't think he's going to do it. But just in case, I'll do it because he almost got my ass off. On the last canter, I don't think I grab it. Okay, so when I said a little bit, it wasn't a normal one. I could still feel his back. You may not see it. He wasn't in a normal run to where I could ride it and we were comfortable. He was tense and his back was bowing, which made me grab the night latch, put me in a different position, and I was a little tense. So he's getting a little tired. He's out of shape. I haven't ridden him in a year. We've walked. He's carried me, and we've ran a few times. He's bucked. It got him nothing but more running and more walking. And he crow hopped a couple times or bowed his back on two more runs, and it got him nothing. On the last one, he's like, okay, I'll just run. We'll be back to normal. I won't say no. And I felt it. You may not see it, but I felt it. I ran him a little bit longer here, a big loop. And he was like, okay, I'm done bucking. I got it. You can make me run. I have to listen to you. I can't buck. I ran him more. I think I run him again. I can't remember. He's such a good one. So on this one, I canter him away to show the startup. And I don't even know if his tail, because I've never seen his tail before. So I don't know if his tail gets active or not. His tail may be telling me no, and I may not even know it. Not too bad. Not bad at all. A horse that really wanted tail, that tail would be swishing. Damn it. No, I'm mad. Stop it. You know, it went up a little bit. So now I'm not holding the night latch. You see both my hands on the reins here? Because he's worked what I call worked out his bucks. He's not the bucking type to buck after you get over his cold back and you first. I just know him. When you get on him cold, he's going to do that. They used to cut a V in a horse's ear if he was a rank horse when they had a horse in lines. And so when you went and grabbed a horse, because there'd be like 50 horses, and you take a horse out and you work them so hard for 2 hours, they're shaking, they can barely stand up, and you're like, you got to go get a new horse. So you pull them over the line, tie them up, and you grab another horse. So you never know what horse you're getting. Well, the rank horses that were bucking and not real broke or would fight you or rear or buck, if they were dangerous, they would cut a little V in the ear. So when you grab that horse, if you saw the V cutting his ear, I think it's mean and cruel. I think it's bullshit. I didn't like it, but that's the way they used to do it. If you got a horse with a V in his ear, you knew. For a while there, you used to still see horses some places with V in the ear because they came from a large area to where they had marked them as a rank horse. So you probably don't want to buy a horse with a V in the ear. I don't think they do it a lot nowadays, but you know, I would never turn down a horse because some idiot cut his freaking ear. He could have tore it on barbed wire. He could have been bit. A lot of horses in the wild have bit up ears because when they fight and they bite the ear.
Much better. All right. I'm okay with that. Huh.
Now, I can tell here that Buddy is kind of like, okay, Dad, I'm going to stop fighting, et cetera. And I got off. Did I write him long? No. Did I write him to go out on the first time and to show him who's boss and to make him a perfect horse because I haven't ridden him in a year? To me, that's not unfair. He rode. He did a few things. I got the buck out. He gave me a few good canters. He listened pretty well. I was good with that. There was no reason for me to keep riding him. Plus, I was kind of hurting. So it's not the end of the world. Some people would say that you didn't ride him too short. You should have ended on a more positive note. You shouldn't have entered on it. They'll have all this advice. And if you read all the comments on these, you're going to see all the crazy advice. You know, maybe it's right. The Chinese farmer. I don't know. You don't know. I think I just unsaddle him. So it's not that big of a deal. He knows to follow me because I always dismount normally and make my horse follow me to get the saddle off. Because if I ever fall off or get off, I want them to follow me thinking I'm going to take the saddle off. So this is just a conditioning thing. If you do what you've always done, you'll get what you've always got. If you always do what you've always done, you'll always get what you've always got. I always make my horse walk to get unsaddled. My horse follows me when I get off to get unsaddled. It's a routine. If you do bad things in a routine, like nag and loud hands and hit your horse with a whip and spur your horse, if you do that, you'll always get what you've always got. If you want change in your horse, you have to change. All right, so took me 2 hours just to go over these three videos, and it wasn't that much. But I think this is a good way to explain for people that, one, either want to hate or judge, they're not going to come here and watch. But if you really want to learn and understand what was going through my mind, what was I thinking when I was doing this? It's hard to explain when you're doing it, everything that you're taking in. Because just like the horse, I'm taking in all kinds of things. Where's Ransom? Is Ransom doing it? Where's my horse looking? Is somebody starting up a tractor? Is there a bag blowing through? Is there cattle? Is there a crisis or something that's going to distract my horse? Is there a train? Is there something that is a helicopter flying by? Is a plane? I mean, I'm always taking in more information and making slight adjustments that you may not see or know. So we'll go down to questions or anything that I explained that you didn't get. I have 370 people, thanks. And we'll take questions. You should have rode longer. Gutter's just being gutter about longer. I know what's going on here. I'm not an idiot. A horse is a horse, of course. You're welcome. Ransom's a cute little horse. Everybody asks, am I going to ride Ransom? Ransom's not my horse, first of all. If he was my horse, I wouldn't ride him. He's too small for me. Plus, Ransom has ringbone in his run, and he's kind of got arthritis, and he limps carrying his own weight. I think it's mean to put somebody, any adult, on him. I think a kid on him would be okay if they're just walking him around. If a kid wanted to get on him and want to go gymkhana or run him and do a bunch, I think that would be mean. But to get on him and walk him around the pasture with a kid, I think he would be fine. So again, when somebody says, when should you not ride? When is it okay? There's too many factors, you know? How much do you weigh? Are you a kid? Are you little? Are you riding slow? Are you running? There's all kinds of things. Let's see. Same concept with dogs. All animals are the same. Principles of conditioning is standard. Stimulus, response, reward. That's it. Stimulus, response, reinforcement. Reinforcement is the same as reward. Okay. Reward for a horse is lack of pressure. I use carrots and apples as a reward sometime. When I get Buddy to pick up my hat, I give him a carrot. So I use food as a reward. I say hat, he picks it up, and I give him a carrot. Stimulus, hat, response, he picks it up, reward, I give him a carrot. All training is that way. Even when you train your kids, that's how bosses train their employees. That's how we train each other for social environments. It's all stimulus, response, reward. You get a stimulus, you get a response, and you either get a reward or you get negative reaction. Your boss tells you to be here at time. Stimulus. You show up late. Reward or reinforcement, negative reinforcement. You get fired, you get written up, you get docked pay. Or you show up on time. He tells you to be on time. You show up on time, you get a raise. You get a promotion. Stimulus, response, reward is a common theme, just like pressure and release. They're all pretty much there. Hang on, let me get to you. How's your leg? The bruised side leg is fine. No big deal. I got a bruise. Kind of looks nasty and yellow and blue, but that's not a big deal. My other leg, my hip, I'm still having a little bit of issue, but I think I just started taking that glycosamine. Yesterday was the first one. I took my second one today, and I've been stretching more. I didn't go to the gym yesterday, and I ate like shit. So I'm going to the gym after I do this live. I thought it was going to be stormy and lightning. It's cloudy. We got rain all night, but it's not stormy. So I'm going to go to the gym after I get done with this live, and I'm going to do some stretching and maybe play a little racquetball and maybe do some weights. But, you know, I'm moving a lot better, to say the least. I notice in a couple of my videos when I'm walking, I've got the old man walk to where I'm doing this. And if I'm sitting down here, so my back's a little sore, but I'm getting a lot more mobility. I can do it and I'm not having pain. I still have a little bit of pain right here. And then right through here, it kind of runs through here and then it'll go down here sometime. And then it goes down the front, and it's not sciatica because it doesn't really go down the back of my leg. It's the side and the front and the hip. A lot of people said it's my hip. I don't know what it is. I mean, it's been going on for 2 or 3 months, but it gets better, it gets worse. If I go get a massage, I'm good for like 2 hours. So everybody that's telling me they think it's a bone, arthritis, my hip, but I don't think a massage would fix that. Because a massage helps, I think it's a muscle or nerve issue and not a worn out jump, new hip issue, what a lot of people are telling me. I mean, it could be a spur or fracture. I don't know. I mean, I could go to the doctor. I got insurance. I can go get freaking MRI, x-ray. I just don't like going to the doctor and do all that shit. I figure it'll get worse or it'll get better. When it gets so bad that, you know, I can't move, then I'll go to the doctor. All right, where are we at here? Just my opinion, but I think you and Buddy worked it out. Yeah, I mean, of course we did. I mean, some people may say that Buddy learned bad lessons at the end of this. Other people say, I think he learned the right lesson. Other people say, I let him get away with too much. Other people say, you were a little hard on him when he bucked. You didn't need to yank on him that hard. I mean, it's a pendulum on what to do, but is there a right and wrong answer? I think the only time I get into wrong is when you're being abusive and unfair and you just set the horse up to fail and you do shit so wrong and so confusing, the horse doesn't know the right answer. That's where I get into wrong. But most things, it's kind of opinion. Yeah, thanks, Judy. Do you think belly sore could have instigated the buck? You said the cinch was close. No, I do not think that. He does have a little sore underneath there. That's not why he bucked. I don't even know if the cinch is even over that sore. I think it's in front of it. So I do not think that instigated. I know Buddy, and he's just a little cold back when you don't ride him a while, and when a first canter, if you canter him too quick, without letting him get really loose and maybe getting a little thing or walking up a couple of hills and kind of exercising him. I mean, if he would have done that and we were out riding and there was a hill close, I would have ran him full blast up that freaking hill, because that's hard work to run up a hill carrying me. And I'd have ran him up that hill full blast. When he got to the top, he'd have been like, bucking would have been the last thing on his mind. But I don't have a hill out here, so I just kind of deal with it that way. I say only a kid on ransom. Yeah, I would agree on that. Let's see. Catch you on the flip side walking around Walnut Festival. Oh, yesterday. I'm paying the full price. The leg injury has knocked me down hard. Have a great day. All right. Take some aspirin. Take a bath. Really enjoyed that. Thanks. Hey, glad you enjoyed it. Ransom's foot is incurable. How old is he? What caused it? His foot is incurable. It's just arthritis and ring bone. we can only guess what caused it. He was bought from ropers, and ropers are really hard. If you're roping cattle or roping any type of roping event or sports, those cowboys are the worst horsemen ever. They treat their horse like shit. People will say, man, they're really good. Their horses really listen. They work the shit out of their horses, and they will sell that horse or get rid of it as soon as it can't win them money or a prize. So I don't think they are great horsemen. They may be able to ride, and they may ride good, and they may look good at doing what they do, but I don't think they're good horsemen. A horseman will never hurt his horse or do something that damages horse, especially permanently. I don't think jumpers are good horsewomen, because jumping a horse does so much damage to the tendons. Horses are not made to jump 50 times a day around a freaking arena and carry a weight and have you land. And it's just horrible on a horse. It just is. So they rode Ransom hard and put away wet. He has a scar on his butt. Probably they broke him hard. Looks like he backed into some sort of stabbing instrument, did some muscle damage. So his back is scarred up. He's got another scar. He's got ring bone. My guess is he was owned by ropers. They beat the shit out of him. They rode the shit out of him. They hurt him. They rode him when he was injured. They rode him when he was too young. They did irreversible damage. And as soon as he stopped performing, he was a pretty horse. They sold him to some little girl. And I don't know if he was sold before these people bought him, but the guy who bought him, he's got kids. He's a good looking horse. The kids were riding him around and he's lame. But I think he knew he was lame when they bought him. They told him he had an injury and he would never be like a good performing horse. And they bought him anyway, gave him a good home. And when I got him, he was kept up there with cattle. He was alone to me because he wouldn't have a horse. But, I mean, he had a good life where he was at. I mean, it was okay. It wasn't a horrible life. He was fed. He had a horse life. He was hanging out. And he didn't have the interaction. He didn't have a herd mate. I mean, he really likes Belle. He likes having a female horse. He likes having the donkeys play with. He likes following Buddy around. Horses like being in a herd. They just feel safer. So it was a good deal. But, you know, that's all we can do is kind of guess. I think Ransom isn't a good idea. Yeah, I agree. I don't think that is good. All righty. Show us where your bruise is. I forgot. Stop it. It's just like, right. I mean, why does everybody say I'm flat? Damn it. I'm not flashing anybody. Like I said, this damn thing. People being crazy just because I got a damn bruise on my leg. It's right here. It's not that big of a deal. It's on my leg. It's here and it's yellow and it kind of goes down to here a couple parts. So, I mean, the horn hit me, I think right here, and then maybe I slid and I did some damage here. It's not that big of a deal. I got so much shit. I showed my bruise on my horse channel. Everybody's like, he's flashing us. I'm like, really? That was a flash because I showed a bruise on my leg? What? All right, where are we at? Bad in equals bad out, good in. Yeah, that's why, you know, computers, when you get things, if you put bad information in, you're going to get bad information out. If you put bad numbers in, you're going to get bad results. When you do bad to a horse, your horse is bad. I always say the horse reflection of you. When your horse does good, you did good. When people blame a horse, say, I got a bad horse. I got a rank horse. I got a mean horse. I got a horse that had a bad trainer. I got a horse that got bad breeding. It's all reflection on blaming the horse because they can't look at themselves and take responsibility. Let's see. What kind of horse is Ransom? They're both quarter horses. Buddy and Ransom are both quarter horses. Ransom is what I would call a Texas quarter horse. Buddy has a bloodline of big roping horses. Cow cutting, maybe. I can't remember what his background is. I covered it in a video about his papers. I showed his papers and stuff. But he's got some really breeding. And remember, when I got Buddy, they told me he has to have shoes. His breed has always had shoes. All his mom has shoes. His dad has shoes. Everybody has shoes. He has to have shoes. They don't have good hooves. They make good big horses and they're strong and smart and they're pretty, but they have bad feet. And that's why I don't like overbreeding. But I've never had shoes on Buddy. Buddy's never had a shoe on his foot. And he's done fine. He's never been lame. So don't believe all this bullshit about how great shoes are and how your horse needs it. All right. I thank you, Rick, for the live. Chaps look good. Let's see. Will you be riding more often, maybe out on trails? Yeah, I don't know if I'll bring him out because he doesn't like to go out alone and he gets nervous just even going on a trail ride anyway. And I don't trail him enough. I could see myself if I rode him around a little bit here or I hooked up with a group that wanted to go riding, bringing him and Ransom and Pony and Ransom and riding Buddy. I mean, I could see me doing that. I wouldn't say he's doing it a lot. What's your opinion of Liberty Training? I keep getting asked that question. And unfortunately, Liberty Training has varied definitions. You know, my definition of Liberty Training is training without anything on a horse, just no lead work, no nothing. Other people may be different. If you can control your horse and work, that's great. Somebody sent me a thing saying that you could ride with no reins. Plenty of people do it. I'm telling you, riding with no reins is cool. It looks good and it works in an enclosed environment. You will not see people out riding. Is that somebody from a horse channel? Oh, that's Jeannie. I'm going to beat her butt. Her son is making these bazookies. Oh my God, they look so good. She says she was going to bring me some. I go, no, she's trying to, I play racquetball with her. And she's really good at racquetball. I don't tell her that. I tell her she's okay, but she is really good at racquetball. And her son, she goes, he's going to make, because we talked about eating it. We went to lunch the other day at a group of us, not me and her. She's married. So everybody be like, oh, he's sleeping. I'm not sleeping with her. She's married. She's got a family, but we play racquetball and she's nice. I like having married friends because there's no issues about being, you know, I've always hung out with my buddies' wives and shit. Their wives always like me. And they, you know, we just connect and they're like, man, you're better than my wife than I am. Go talk to her. Go do her shit. You can go do the woman shit on, because they don't want to deal with their wives. So I was always hanging out with my buddy's wives. Anyway, so her son making bazookies, and she just put me pictures. I don't know if you guys can see the pictures of the bazookies, but they look pretty stinking good. Yeah, I can never get the pictures on here. It says chocolate chip with walnuts. Oh my God, that sounds freaking great. I freaking love those with a scoop of ice cream at BJ's. I don't know if you guys have them. Bazooki is a big cookie hot out of the oven, and they put a fresh scoop of ice cream. Then you eat the cookie. I like the white chocolate macadamia nut, but I digress. Don't get me on food. I got to go to the gym. I told her she wants to give me those just to make me fat so she can beat me. And she's like, I don't need to give you that to beat you. I was like, whatever. All right, reward can be food or praise or positive action. Yeah, but negative reinforcement or negative reward is a negative action to a negative response. So if I want my horse, I'll use a dog because it's easier. If I want my dog to sit and I tell him to sit, when he sits, I give him food or a pat or good positive reinforcement. If I tell him to sit and he spins around and growls at me, I'm going to give him negative reinforcement. If I know he knows what sit means, I don't use negative until you can't use negative reinforcement until you know the animal knows what you want. So if I do sit and my dog sits every time I tell it to sit, 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 and he doesn't. And then all of a sudden I tell him to sit and he doesn't sit, he turns around and growls at me. That's not the response I wanted. That's not what he's supposed to do. That's not what he knows he's supposed to do. I'm going to correct that. And he's going to get negative reinforcement, either a yank on the jerk chain, either a no, either pull him, either grab him and put him in a sit position and go sit. So that's a negative. A lot of people don't think you should do negative, kind of like, you know, you shouldn't spank your kid. You should do timeout, whatever. I'm just telling you how they train and how I've trained dogs and what works. Okay. Negative reinforcement, I think, is needed sometime, even on a horse. When Buddy bucked, he got negative reinforcement. Tight reins. No, I took his head away. I made him back up. That was all negative reinforcement. I was telling him that is not the right answer. You better connect bucking with me getting in your face. Okay. Now, I don't want to do that with a bit because now I'm causing pain and hurt, and pain normally doesn't teach. When I was doing that, I was making a backup, taking his head away. Could he have gotten pain from a rope? There's idiots out there saying a rope halter does more damage than a bit. That's just absolutely ridiculous. It's just crazy. Bits are torture devices, period. Okay, people are going to call punishment. I don't like using punishment, but it kind of is. Let's see. Not related to video. Do you have any plans to upload more on your dog channel? Not really without a dog. My buddy that came and we worked on this light really is reflecting over here. Let me kind of dim this down and see. Does that help? Does that help? Shit, I don't even know. And that light, for some reason, the daylight was, I'm getting a lot of reflection on my screen here. Not really, but my buddy brought his dog over yesterday, and his name is Colt. He's a gun guy. So he named him Colt after Colt Firearms. And really cute lab. I love that dog. And he's just a super great dog. So he was running around. I go, dude, can you stop him if he goes after rabbit? He goes, oh yeah. And right about then he walked over to get a drink by where Stewie hides, and Stewie took out of the bushes and went off. And Colt was like, something's running. I need to chase it. So he went after it. And you know, his dad yelled, Colt, and he stopped, turned around, came back. And the rabbit, and I never saw the rabbit again for the rest of the day. But I saw him this morning, he's fine. But he got chased. It's no big deal. And then Colt's running around out here sniffing, and he disappeared, and the horses came in, and he's been around his horse, so he thinks he's okay, but he thinks he's a little clueless, and he's going to walk right there and get caught. But anyway, his dog came, went to lunch. He left the dog in the car with the air conditioner on. Anyway, so I didn't do any training with his dog, so I didn't do any videos. Let's see. Rick, do you agree with Caesar? I don't watch Caesar enough to agree or disagree. On my dog channel, I did a couple of videos where I thought he was taking unnecessary risk. However, he has the same kind of philosophy, I think, from what people tell me, that he blames the owner of the dog more than he blames the dog. And I believe he thinks the same as I think most horse problems are people problems. I think he believes that most dog problems are people problems. So do I agree with him or disagree with him? If I say yes, somebody will show a video, man, listen with Caesar, didn't you agree with him? And I'll be like, oh shit, I don't agree with that. So I really can't say, I don't know him enough. I saw your forward motion prior to the buck, thought you were going, yeah, I did too. Believe me, I was like, shit, I was in pain, pissed off. Okay, calcium deficiency, really? See, I'm getting diagnosed. Check your shoes. What about my shoes? I'm not wearing shoes. What the hell does that mean? Check your shoes. What? Thank you so much, Rick. I'm starting to really get it because of you. Well, good. I'm glad. Pinched nerve. I don't think it's a pinched nerve. I had a pinched nerve in my back, and the pain is different. I don't think it's a pinched nerve. It could be a nerve, irritated nerve, but I don't think it's a pinched nerve. Chiropractor will help. Every time I go to a damn chiropractor, they want to take my damn neck and snap it, and it pisses me off, and I tell them I don't like that shit. I hear, and I'm like, oh, I just don't like it. It never freaking fixes anything, and it's like that's the go-to for a freaking chiropractor. If they can't snap your freaking head, they're not happy. So that's why I stopped going to chiropractors, because I tell them I don't want you to snap my head. Well, I need to realign and I need to adjust, and that's part of the process. And I can't really have you telling me what I need to do. I need to get in there and figure out what's going on and then see what I need to do. And it always ends up, they want to go. I've only been like three times, but every time has been the freaking neck snap. And I'm just like, you're not snapping my freaking neck. I'm tired of it. Okay. Yeah, somebody got me this shirt. I don't know who. What does it say? Hey, horse people. All right. Let's see here. Incredible ignorant. I use my voice. I can't use my legs. Dude, my dad has the same issues. It was his back, especially. I don't have tingling in my toes. And another guy told me it was my back too, and it was a herniated disc. But I don't have tingling in my toes, and maybe it is. I mean, I don't know. Someone else told me acupuncture also. I did that shit on Mr. T. He had like 50 little needles all in him. I felt so sorry for him. And I didn't see any change in him. So I'm not sure about the acupuncture. What if my horse is my boyfriend? You can identify whatever you want. It's called aging happens. It sucks. Physical therapy. I went to physical therapy. I ain't buying no damn cane. I'm not that bad. Shit. Anyway, physical therapy. I went there for a while. It helped a little bit. I just had to drive to where my insurance would take my physical therapy almost an hour. So I drive an hour wasting gas. I sit there for 30 minutes to do these stupid little stretches. Then I drive an hour back, and then I have to meet with them two or three times. Then I have to pay a $30 copay each time. And I'm like, shit, I'm paying all this money. I said, it's not helping that damn much. I'd rather have the pain. So I stopped physical therapy. Rick, you should listen. Whatever. You are right about your hip pain, the anti-inflammatory. Yeah, a lot of people said it has to do with inflammation. And if I do some, I took an aspirin the other night. I don't like taking pain meds, but I did take an aspirin the other night because it was really hurting. I didn't notice a big difference. So I was like, I'm not even taking that shit anymore. Okay. If you rode every day, your hip will probably eventually feel better. I agree. I think either buddy bucking or doing that, I think it loosened me up or did something, because I do ever since then. I was sore the next day, worse, but ever since then, it's gotten a little bit better. But I'm changing so much, it's hard to tell. Is it because I'm stretching? Is it because I took a little break off racquetball? Is it because I took a little break off weights? I mean, I was doing some sit-ups and some back bends on some weights, and when I'm finished, my back's on fire. And I mean, it's just like so sore, and then it stiffens up. So I've kind of changed so many things. I don't know what's working. So, but it's getting better. So screw it. Whatever I'm doing, I'm going to keep doing. Buck because he's buddy sour. Nah, I don't think it's because he's buddy sour. I don't like using that term. You don't really know what happened until they respond with emotion. Bye, fellas. Okay, I'm not getting a whole lot of questions here. Tendons, ligaments, it's all about my back now. Before I go, Rick. What? Rick, a lot of pain has to do with inflammation and joints, tendons. I know, anti-inflammatory. I know, I should. I just don't like taking meds. Liberty training. Again, with the Liberty training. Man, mom's really stuck on Liberty training. I thought I kind of already discussed that, didn't I? All right. Hang on. I'm working my way down these things. Oregon. It's his sac. Is that like the sciatica nerve or sciatica? I don't know what sac is. Like when you say sac, I'm thinking of something else. The horn almost hit his horn. I almost got it in Twig and Berries. It was above and to the right, but it did. That's not a good hit either. You would have seen me roll off and cry like a little girl. Buddy, in my Twig and Berries. I must be getting ring foot food is not genetic. I think he's got ring bone, and that's not genetic. That's usually from injury. I think. I could be wrong. I'm getting my nice leg comment because of the bruise. I must be getting down to comments where I showed my bruise. I'm late. You are still on this topic. Shoes mess up. Oh, are they talking about horseshoes? Yeah, I'm very anti-shoe on horses. The horse I had was a cattle cutter. Yeah, they're pretty limber and pretty quick on their movements. They get low. They're usually shorter and lower to the ground so they can move good. If it was raining today, I was actually going to saddle Buddy up and ride in the rain. But it's not raining. So I got to get to the gym. What time is it? It's 11:30 here right now, or 11:22. No, Rick is not single. I'm not single? Really? Why are you saying that? Did somebody ask if I was single? Did I miss that? How do you not know? Oh, are you single? Why are you asking? Are you like trying to do research or get my background? You want to look up marriage license? What's going on? He timed that perfectly. Negative, positive. Seems that's how you train men to it if they don't mind pulling their chain. Pew pew's high. Chief smoke a lot's high. I'm working my way down in my comments. I mean, I'm pretty far behind. I'm not getting a whole lot of questions, just a lot of comments. All right. So I guess. Oh, hang on, what is this? Rick, is Liberty a good idea? I've been asking for a while, but I want your opinion. Mom, I thought I questioned this. Liberty training is working with nothing. If you can do it in a controlled area, it works. If it's not in a controlled area, I don't think you should be riding your horse with nothing on his neck until you trust him a lot, especially not out of a controlled area. When I talked about riding with nothing on a horse's face or neck, somebody sent me that video of Stacy. Stacy was riding. She did a great routine, I think, for her dad or something with her horse. She did a great job. It looked great. It looked perfect. It was wonderful. It was great horsemanship. She is not riding her horse around on trails and riding her horse around traffic and cars and around dangers with nothing on his head. It's just not going to happen. If you can't control a horse and they know that you can't control them, they are going to respond, react, and move out. You have to be able to take control of your horse, and you cannot do that with nothing on their head. You can ride with a loop rein. I can ride Buddy around in closed air with loop rein. He'll do fine. But if I took Buddy on a long ride at an in area that we have too close, he is not going to respond near as much. And the odds of him taking off into run and saving his own butt and me stopping him is slim to none. So I'm not saying it can't be done. I'm just saying it looks cool when you have an arena and you've practiced it and you've done it 50 times and the horse knows the routine and you go to a circus act and the horses run and a guy stands on their back and the horses do. If you do something enough and the horse knows exactly what it's going to do and that's what he's going to do, he will do it in a closed and secure environment and make you look good. But nobody's out there riding around horses with nothing on their face. Liberty training is training with nothing. I'm assuming, I don't know if they use whips. I already said there's multiple ideas. Mom, if you ask this question again, I'm blocking you because I've answered this and I've said it and I've covered it and I've read your comments several times. I hate when repetitive comments come when I've already addressed it. Liberty training is fine depending on how you use it. Whether it works or not is whether you do it right or wrong. There's too many variables to say liberty is good or liberty is bad. Sometimes it's bad, sometimes it's good. I think I've covered this, Mom. All right. Rick, why are you being mean to her? I'm just trying to move on. Start taking fish oil. I'm already taking too much shit. I'm taking a multivitamin and that glycosamine now. How old is Buddy? You have to go to the website. Rick's back. I don't know what that means. Please make some more laugh at long. I haven't talked to Lester since his dog died. That dog dying was pretty traumatic. I mean, he sent me some videos when he first did that. And he texted them to me. And I was like, dude, I think it was a massive stroke. A heart attack usually causes some sort of chest compression or arm stiffening. There's usually, you can see the pain with a heart attack. And this man, Maggie, just walked out there and just literally just fell over. I mean, it was like the lights went off. It was like somebody shot her in the head with a sniper rifle and she fell. I mean, it was, her fall to me was very telling that there was a complete disconnect in either central, in police training, when you shoot for sniper, we want to disconnect the spine from your head. So you shoot for the ear or nose. If you hit with a bullet anywhere in this circle around your head, you can't even pull a trigger before you die. You're dead before you hit the ground. It severs what's called your celery stalk, your spinal cord right here. And when you sever that, your body can't do anything. If you're shot in the heart or anywhere else, you can still pull a trigger. You can be shot in the lungs and be bleeding out, and you're going to be dead in 10 seconds. But in those 10 seconds, you're still allowed to walk, and you can squeeze a gun and shoot triggers. The only way to really stop a person, and that's why in a sniper school, you're always taught the headshot. If somebody's got a gun to someone's head, you have to make the headshot in order to separate the celery stalk so he can't pull the trigger. That's it. Well, the way his dog fell, I would say that dog got, the celery stalk was disconnected and she was shot in the head because she just went over. It was done. There was no convulsing. There was no moving. There was nothing. Now, he did try some compressions and CPR on her, and she was moving then, but I think the lights went out when she fell and it was done. And I mean, that's not the worst way in the world to go. If I want to go, hell, I hope I go that way. I hope I'm walking on the pasture with my horses, don't know what's coming, and just fall, drop dead right there. Perfect. I don't want to, you know, be hanging around fighting some disease or a bunch of whatever. I mean, if I got to go, that's a pretty good way. So I told him, I was like, man, she wasn't in pain or nothing. When she went, lights were out. She was done. But I haven't talked to him since then. Other than commenting on his video. I'm not one to go to chiropractors, each your own. Yeah, I don't know. Rick is single for a long life. I'm not gay. What? Did somebody call Pew Pew gay? I do liberty. Again, what's the definition of liberty? I mean, has anybody ever looked up the damn definition of liberty? Let me look up. Hang on. Oh, shit. I did shop sharing. I wanted to share. Oh, shit. I'm already sharing. Damn it. Liberty. Horse. Oh, hang on. I got to move this over here where you can see it. Sorry. Liberty training. There we go. I didn't even give a definition, really? Of course not, because it's everybody's thing. horse liberty definition. Liberty training is designed to bring a horse a sense of freedom and safety without using any tact, including halters or ropes. Working with a horse in this way will increase the horse's desire to interact. Maybe, if you do it right, maybe not. Maybe it'll teach a horse that you're an idiot and you don't know what you're doing. And will create a deeper bond and a dependable performance under saddle. Man, that sounds like it was written by a woman. Rick, what? It just has a lot of feelings in it. Does anybody else just feel the definition? Designed to bring a horse a sense of freedom and safety without using tack or halters. Working with a horse in this way will increase your horse's desires, his innermost desires, to interact and will create a deeper bond in love and trust and a dependable performance under saddle. I just don't think a guy wrote that. Sorry. Rick, you're a sexist. All right, whatever. I'm freaking crazy. Bella would get pounded by Buddy. Buddy would definitely be above her. Rick, do you think horses miss riding? Can give signals they want to ride again? No, I don't think horses miss riding. I think riding is work. Do horses miss interaction if they're alone? Do horses look forward to maybe doing things if the rider takes them out to their friends or they have a job? I think horses like to have purpose. They like routine. If you routinely ride a horse, I think a horse will get into that routine and will not only accept it, but kind of look forward to it or expect it or accept it. But do they look forward to it or miss it? I don't know. That might be a human emotion we assign to them that they miss it and they want to go. They may want to go because they're used to it. It's routine. They know what's going to happen. Yeah. Does a horse get bored? I think a horse left alone gets bored. I think a horse with another horse, depending on what goes on around it, do they get bored? If they're locked in a stall, yes, they get bored. They get deadly bored. Do they get bored if they're allowed to roam around and kind of see the wind and run from trees and chase ghosts or goose or horses or get scared from a deer jumps in or a pig comes in? I think horses like mental stimulation. They need to be with a herd and they need to feel like they're working and they got a job. But locking them up, I don't think any horse or human likes that. My husband passed a couple years ago. Lots of memories. Don't want to date. Doubt I'll ever go there again. Seeing you trying to decipher these sometimes cryptic comments is hilarious. I know. People like when I get all confused in a comment. All right. All right, Mom. Sorry, I left for a bit. I won't ask again. Oh, okay. Don't feel bad. I wasn't being mean to you. I don't remember seeing you a lot, but I seen your comment a lot and I did address it. So sometimes trolls will come here and intentionally ask the same question over to irritate me. So when I go off like that, I'm just letting you know, if you're a troll, I'm not going to put up with it. But if it was honest, it's not a big deal. I don't want you feeling bad or thinking I chewed you out on live camera and I'm trying to make you look, it wasn't about that, Mom. I just, all right, let's see here. Buddy's 18 and a half. Is that how old he is? I was closer to 20. So him and Ransom are the same age. Because when I talked to the owner, I think when we went over birthdays, him and Buddy's are about the same age. Buddy's had a good life and not been abused. Ransom has had a hard life and was abused. And you can tell the difference in the two. Let's see here. I'm sorry for Lester. Yeah, that was kind of sad. I am too. Losing a dog is tough. That's probably one of the biggest reasons I kind of don't want to get a dog, because I get really attached. I get attached to all my animals, but I really get attached to dogs because they lock onto you and you spend a lot of time. Stroke or brain hemorrhage. That's what I was thinking. I thought Maggie had an aneurysm. Another thing that I thought. Snap the spine. Does Lester act like an idiot on purpose? Sometimes he does. Lester does go for views and he kind of sets up things because he calls his channel entertainment. He's out there to entertain his audience. I like my channel to be more educational. I want people to learn and to think. And that's what my channel is. Although I do get some entertainment and joking and, you know, sexual talk and just screwing around, being, having fun. I like having fun, but I want my channel to give something back. I mean, I just don't want to do this to entertain. That's not me. I mean, I don't mind entertaining, having fun when I'm teaching, but I really want my stuff, my time to be passing on either about our history, our constitution, freedoms, the worries and the mistrust of government, the country, my patriotism, the things I believe in, the First Amendment, the Second Amendment, owning a gun, owning horses. Horses are freedom. Horses built our country. Giving back to horses and to people that want to learn on my experience. I'm not saying I'm right. I know everything. I just got a few years on earth, a few decades on the earth, and I'm passing on to people. You know, when we used to live in smaller communities and we did more parties and more community and we're more related, you got a lot of what I think I'm giving from parties or from uncles or grandpas or from friends. And we had our 4th of July parties and maybe Thanksgiving dinners. And you got to interact with different people and they gave you little bits of life lessons along the way. We don't have that now because, you know, we got the internet and the phone and we're busy and we're doing it. We got our lives and we're moving and we're, you know, this. So you've lost a lot of that being able to share from the older generations who learned some value lessons. We don't know everything. We made our mistakes. We're not perfect, but I'm not connected to everybody's old no more than I'm connected to every guy or every horseman or every cop or every military dude. I'm just a guy. But we've lost that ability to share things. The internet has made that so wonderful. And that's why my website is built around almost all my website on both the cop channel and this. They're both about learning and passing on good bits of information that hopefully will help somebody and that'll be passed on to others. To me, knowledge is nothing if you hoard it and just want to have it so you can say you're the smartest guy in the room. That's not good knowledge to me. Knowledge is only good if it can be shared to advance and help other people. In my opinion, Lester's not an idiot. He's naturally funny and great and I don't think Lester's an idiot either. Some people may think that. He's got his haters. Did Rick ride Buddy this morning? No, I didn't. I rode him a few days ago, which is why you can see the bruise. If I showed you my leg before, you would not see the bruise. Look at those big old ears on that rabbit. Well, I mean, I like to think I'm a pretty good teacher. Most people I teach tend to be pretty good. I taught rappelling. You know, I taught weapons, I taught tactics, I taught in academy police driving and weaponless defense and baton. So I've got a lot of teaching, and normally the best teacher is experience. Okay, I tell people, you want to be a good horseman, you need experience riding a horse. You're not going to be a good horseman watching videos or watching horses or listening to other people about horses. You get good with horses by doing it. Confucius says, if I hear, I forget. If I see, I remember. If I do, I understand. Doing is the understanding experience. That's how you get the thing. You can't just get it by listening or watching. You'll never be that good. Okay. Nobody gets the top of their game, either in basketball, football, karate, whatever your goal is. You don't get to the top by watching and hearing. You'll never be at the top. You get to the top by doing, performing, learning, making mistakes, correcting, being an expert at your area of expertise. All right, I think I'm caught up. Oh, no, shit, it just jumped. Damn it. Rick, did the neighbors find their... No, the dogs never came back. That freaking pisses me off. I can't talk about that. Poor little dog. 2:30 a.m. here? Damn. You better get your butt to bed. It's 11:30 here in Texas. And I'm about to end this because I got to get my ass to the gym. I've only had one cup of coffee this morning. Well, maybe two. I had to fill up before I came. But I still got to drink another cup of coffee before I go to the gym. Usually have three cups. I drank this full cup while I'm on my way to the gym because I got to drive 30 minutes. So I'll fill this up and I'll sip on it on the way to the gym. It'll be gone by the time I get there. Did you hear about the guy who lost his horse to a wild herd in Utah desert? After 8 years, he got it again. I did not hear that. I always kind of wanted to kind of my dream a little bit was to find a wild herd and let Tanner loose in it. But I knew he wouldn't, he was old, and if somebody saw him with a brand, you know, they wouldn't know he's wild and they wouldn't want to try and catch him because he was good looking. And I was like, if I knew he would be out in the wild herd, I would have let him go. But there was too many variables that I couldn't control. So Lex Lester is a creator. Rick is an informer. I might agree with that. I try to be anyway. Sometimes people think I'm informing wrong and I'm a dumbass. So to each his own. Lester is so caring, funny, educational. Lester and Jamie both are really good people. I'm telling you, man. Those people are just good, salt of the earth, down to earth, good Texas folk. Let's see here. Damn, I thought I was at the end. All right, I'm at the end. This is the last comment that I see. Need to rub that bruise out. I don't rub the bruise. I just leave it alone. Are you being funny? Are you making a sexual innuendo? That's a nice spider you got there. Is that an orbital spider? Anyway, I'm out of here. Y'all have a good one. Epsom salt. Hey, I got to give y'all, hang on 1 second. I'm going to give you my miracle drug that Buck, the gun guy, turned me on to. Hang on. So this is the shit. I ordered this on Buck's advice. It's like Epsom salt. It's called magnesium bath flakes. And it's on Ancient Minerals. I think this bag was, I don't remember, $30 maybe? I don't remember. But it's a lot. And it's heavy. And you probably don't need this much. But you mix this 50-50 with water. Get some warm water. And then you put the same amount of bath flakes in there, and it turns into an oil, and you spray it on an area with pain, and it freaking helps. When Buck told me this, I was like, dude, I'm not spraying some bullshit. He calls it magnesium spray. He's got a little bottle. And he goes, dude, just go to the back and spray this on your hand and rub it into your area that hurts. I go, this is some snake oil shit. I was giving him shit. I went back there. And like 5 minutes later, it's throwing, like, dude, I think my back feels better. He goes, I told you. I go, that's just a miracle drug. So I showed all my racquetball buddies, who's got a pain? I'm going to spray this on you. So now they call it my miracle juice. And they said, I got to spray down my whole body with that shit. But this shit freaking works. I'm telling you, I put it in a spray bottle. And it only, I mean, if you're just going to use it for the spray bottle, this bag will last you. It'll outlive you. You'll never use it all. I mean, it takes a little bit and you mix it 50-50 with water and it turns into a little spray. And I'm telling you, I rubbed it on my knees and on my back, and that shit freaking worked, and the pain got better. He says there's something about the magnesium that penetrates and it gets it into the inflammation at the source. I don't know if it's snake oil or not, but I'm telling you, it freaking worked for me. And I mean, I took a bath in it the other day, so I put a bunch of handfuls and poured a bunch of it in the bathtub and laid it and soaked in it a little bit. I didn't notice a big difference when I got out of the bathtub, but when I spray that shit on and rub it in, I definitely know a difference. And it has no smell, and it's my miracle shit now, thanks to Buck. Anyway, I digress. I got to get the hell out of here. All right, I got 385 people here. All right, so I'm going to make this part 4 of the 3-part series. So if you watch the 3-part and you will come here, hopefully this will tie everything together on the writing, and it'll clear up any confusion. Most people don't like to invest time. We're in an age to where we want fast results, quick. Google this, Google that. I ask Alexa to answer a question, I get the answer. Everything is this. So people don't like to invest. And a lot of people, you know, I'm always getting advice, don't do long videos because nobody watches it. I see a long video, I don't even watch it. I mean, that's unfortunate, because as an instructor, if you go to a class, you may sit in a class for an hour class and you have to go for 6-8 weeks, you know, 22 weeks, whatever the class is. It takes a while to become knowledgeable on a subject. And horses are not just, you know, oh yeah, I watched this video, I can go do it. It just doesn't work. So hopefully this will move on. Anyway, I'm out of here. Y'all have a good one. Thanks for coming. And we'll end that there. Mom Taylor, nice. the likes have gone up. Last I saw it was 100 and only 116. Now it's at 340. Thanks for the likes. YouTube likes it. I personally don't give a shit. But YouTube will promote this vehicle and get the information out if people like it. So that's the only reason I encourage you to like it. It doesn't, I mean, it supposedly helps the channel and it helps get the videos recommended to other people. So whatever. All right. Y'all have a good one. 412 likes. Yay. I can't see the likes on here because I'm on the other one. So, wait a minute. Humans are compromised to mineral. What? Human are compromised of mineral. I thought we were like coal and carbon or something. I can't remember. I forgot all my science biological shit. I'm still trying to figure out why Buddy tried to kill me. He didn't try to kill me. All right. Y'all have a good one.